Radio presents Leading with My Chin, written and read by me, Jay Leno. Biologically speaking, I came late to the party, which is to say, when I was born, my mom was 41, my dad was 42, and my brother was already 10. I may not have gotten here on schedule, but at least I got here. I'm a half-breed of the oddest sort, one part Scottish, one part Italian. The combination makes no sense because each side couldn't be more diametrically opposed. My mother, Catherine, was born in Scotland, and my dad, Angelo, was a first-generation Italian-American. And I seem to be divided right down the middle. My Scottish side, practical, analytical, even a bit frugal. The Italian side, loud, outgoing, ready to laugh and be laughed at. Of course, my mother never really understood the Italian part of my behavior. When I was a boy, she would always scold me, "There's a time to be serious and a time to be funny." But in truth, there was never a time to be funny. We could be at Disneyland. My mom would say, "Not now! Not now, Mom. When am I supposed to be funny? We're at Disneyland. Seems like it's always time to be serious." She would later watch me do my stand-up comedy and make little notes. I'd ask how she'd like the show, and she would say, "But why can't you sing a little song and do a little dance? Nobody likes jokes all the time. Nobody wants someone to be funny all the time." The most entertaining spectacle in my youth was to watch both sides of my family try to interact. Each side obviously had totally different attitudes and approaches to life. At the Italian functions on my father's side, there would be hundreds of meatballs for maybe 8 people. More food than anyone could possibly eat. Huge pots, huge portions. My mother's sister, Aunt Nettie, would be incensed by this. "Look at the food, Jamie. The food that's going to waste. The waste." If there were more than 2 lights burning in any room, she'd scream, "I can't believe it. All these lights. The waste of electricity, Jamie. The waste." Then we go to my Aunt Nettie's house, which was run on the safer side of frugality. I remember how she used to keep Coca-Cola in the cupboard because to refrigerate even one bottle, of course, would quadruple the cost of electricity. There's nothing like that sound of a warm Coke being opened that and then seeing all foam pour out and no liquid. And then a delicious, nice, stale scone. A Scottish dream snack, Jamie. But my Aunt Nettie was a very lovely woman. She came to America when she was a small girl, and my mother followed her years later, moving in with Nettie and her husband, Alec. Now, Uncle Alec was the classic Scotsman, by which I mean extremely thrifty. I remember my dad telling this story about when my Uncle Alec fell down and lost consciousness for a few minutes. My dad was there and bent down to help. He shouted, "Give him some air," and opened Alec's shirt and then put his hand around his waist to try and loosen his pants. At that moment, Alec snapped awake and started squeezing my dad's hand so hard he almost broke it. "You're not getting me wallet, Angus. You're not fetching me wallet." My mom's family used to call my dad Angus instead of Angelo. I think they thought Angus was Scottish for Angelo. Anyway, my dad thought this was the funniest thing he ever heard of when he got, the feeling back in his hand. Later in life, my mom always tried to instill the Scottish thriftiness upon me in the sneakiest way. For example, she never quite understood why an adult single guy didn't save old French fry oil. Back home, you can go in my mom's basement and find jars marked Bacon Fat 1959. This then explained, of course, the mysterious appearance of yellowy, grease-filled bottles I'd find in my cupboards when they visited me in California. I'd say, "Ma, what am I going to do with this stuff?" And she'd say, "You never know when you might need it." Whenever I feel the overwhelming need to get ptomaine poisoning. I remember the first time they flew out here, she was just enthralled with the meal on the airplane. She said, "Oh, the sandwich was delicious. It was so good. I asked the attendant to wrap up the other half for you." Then she hands me this soggy napkin at the airport. I said, "Ma, I don't want half of an airline sandwich." "Well, put it in the icebox. It's delicious. You'll eat it later." Yeah, it stayed there for 1.5 years. I think it was there the next time they came out to visit. And of course, on their visits, Mom would insist on cooking all the time, which seemed like a ridiculous way to spend a vacation to me. To give her a break, I'd usually bring her home Chinese food. Even this had horrible repercussions. She refused to throw out, those little unused packets of hot mustard and soy sauce. Never mind, I had bottles of this stuff lying around. I'd start dumping them, and she'd say, "You're not going to throw that away." So I'd keep the silly things, and then when they left, I'd just have this big purge of the kitchen. I'd go through all the drawers and the cookie jars, scoop up hundreds of little packets of condiments and plastic forks, and then I'd mail them back to her. You never know when she might need them. I never forget one horrific night they were staying with me. I came in late and they'd already gone to sleep. And on the way home, I'd stopped off to gather the ingredients for the perfect hamburger, which I love to make for myself. I gotten this freshly ground, incredibly lean meat at this special butcher. I gone to this bakery for the rolls, bought one roll and a new bottle of Heinz ketchup because I thought we were all out. Anyway, when I got home, I opened the refrigerator and I see a half bottle of ketchup, and I thought, well, maybe I'm not out. Fine, I'll use that. So I make the hamburger, toasted the bun, put the burger on it. Now for the final touch, the ketchup. I tip the bottle over, splash, it comes out like a gusher. It's like tomato water. I go, what is this? It soaked the meat. The bun is now soaking wet. I start yelling and screaming, ah! Ah! My mom comes down, what's going on there, buddy? Mom, what'd you do to the ketchup? She said, oh, you know, it was a little low, so I put a bit of water in there to make it last longer. You watered down my ketchup, you ruined my hamburger. Of course, this moment, I pretend to start choking her, which my mother thought was hysterical for some reason. She always liked it when I pretend to choke her. Did you ruin my hamburger, you crazy old woman? Of course, my father comes in, what the hell's going on? Your wife ruined my hamburger. My mother's still sputtering. The ketchup was a little low. I just mixed water. Ma, I spent $22 putting that hamburger together. Now it's a puddle. I ate it anyway. But the waste. The waste. You know, making my mom laugh was always a great source of pleasure to me. She was somewhat withdrawn, probably from the effects of having a horrible childhood back in Scotland. Something I didn't learn until much later. Her parents divorced in an era when divorce was almost unknown. My understanding is that her mother ran off another man, but this was never discussed much. That left her father with four children to care for, which was more than he could handle. Although it sounds odd, it was customary in those days to give away a child when there were too many of them in a Scottish home, and that's what happened to my mom. She told me a story about the time her dad brought her to a woman to see if the woman would temporarily take her in. This is a wonderful example of how naive my mom was her whole life. Apparently this woman lived at the seaport, and as my mom would tell it, she was very nice to me. I didn't want to stay. The funny thing was, this woman had lots of uncles and brothers who would come over every day. In fact, every day a different uncle or brother would bring me a gift. You know, the first time I heard that, I said, Ma, you know, I think that was a brothel. I think you were staying in a brothel. Oh, no, nothing of the kind, Jamie. Ma, you said it was by the docks? Yes. And different men would come over every day and bring presents? Yes. Ooh, yeah. Maybe you're right. Yeah, maybe it was something.
She was still a little girl when she left Scotland in 1923. 6 years later, I took her back for the first time, along with my dad and my wife, Mavis. My mom was worried that things might not have changed since she left during the war, and she was packing for this trip. She actually asked, should I bring toilet paper and soap? I said, Ma, I think we'll be staying indoors at the nice hotels. So we're off to Glasgow, where she spent her childhood. For a time, she had worked there as a servant girl in this big manor house, and she would always tell me that part of her job was to polish this enormous long table that stood in the foyer of this mansion. It would always take her forever to do it. I said, well, let's see if we can find that house. Come on, just for fun. Now, she wasn't convinced this was a good idea. My mom was still ashamed of having been a servant girl. I said, Ma, nobody cares about that in America. Come on, let's go. You know, I think she was afraid, actually, that people would give her a rag and make her stop polishing the table again. Anyway, Glasgow had changed because of the war, and she wasn't sure how to find the house, so I stopped to please him. It must have been 75, and I asked him for some directions. My mom said to him, you know, I grew up here, and she told him what school she attended. Ah, the policeman said, I went to that school myself. When were you there? Oh, 1919, my mom said. Good heavens, the cop said, somewhat recognizing him. You look much older. The Scottish, I guess, have their own special way of appealing to a woman's vanity. My mom, in any case, thought this was very funny. Mavis, my wife, probably would have killed me that. Anyway, we finally find the big house, which had now been divided up into condominiums, so we rang the bell and got into the main foyer, and the table was still there. My mother was amazed. Well, this is the table, she said. So right there on the spot, I tried to buy it. I told her, Mom, I'm going to buy this table, and you're going to spend the rest of your life polishing this table at my house. And of course, again, she thought this was hysterical. Although she did look slightly relieved that the guy said, no, no, you wouldn't sell it with any price. It came with the house. Next, we tried to find the site of the house where she was born. So we went to Captain's Road, where it stood before the bombing during the war. Meanwhile, rain was pouring down. My father's hollering, what the hell are we doing here in the goddamn rain? And my mother, totally disoriented, wandering in circles, muttering, I know it's here somewhere. And this went on for about 45 minutes. Finally, she spotted some half-destroyed cement staircases that went nowhere, and she stared at them for a while. I said, Ma, do you think this is it? Oh, I'm not sure. It might be. Because I knew how to get a rise out of my mama, so it was the perfect moment. So I went over and grabbed her by the neck like I was choking her again and started screaming, the money! You crazy old woman! Where did you bury the money? You said it was here! And of course, my mother, who was 70, just fell down in the street laughing hysterically in the rain. Mama always had an odd sense of humor. As an immigrant to this country, she lived in constant fear of breaking the law. Deportation, in her mind, was always just around the corner. I used to do a joke about this. I'd say that twice a month, Mom checked the mattress tags, making sure they were on there, good and tight, just in case the police should come and want to inspect the bedding. The truth is, although she was incredibly bright, my mother was always embarrassed about her level of education. I don't think it extended much beyond the third grade. She never told me. For that reason, she always stressed the importance of education to me, which was kind of sad because I may have been the worst student in the history of academia. Probably the last written test Mom ever took was her American citizenship exam, which she passed only barely under very funny circumstances. But in her heart, she felt that she had failed and only be a matter of time before the immigration agents showed up. The story, as I heard it, was that my father took her to the local immigration department where the citizenship tests were given. You could miss up to 4 questions in order to pass, and on this day, Mom missed 5. She flunked the test. And the question she flunked was, "What is the Constitution of the United States?" The answer my mother gave was, "A boat," which wasn't entirely wrong. The USS Constitution was docked in Boston Harbor, and it was a boat. But the judge instantly denied her citizenship anyway. My father caused outrage. He stormed the judge and started berating the guy. "What the hell is this? Why did she fail? Let me see that test. She's not wrong. The Constitution is a boat. The woman got the question right. What the hell are you doing?" Of course, the judge rolled his eyes and said, "No, the Constitution is our basic governing, but it's a boat. It's in Boston. Am I wrong? It's a boat. She got it right." "Sir, you asked her what it is, and she said it's a boat. The Constitution, same thing." The judge said, "All right, that's it. Oh, for Christ, here you go. Fine, you passed the TAM test. There, she's a citizen. Just get out of here." So my father showed my mom, "See, you passed." "Oh, I didn't pass," she whimpered. "They're going to come after you." "Oh, they're not going to come after you. The man said you, but you got it wrong." "No, you didn't get it wrong." My mom worried about this until the day she died. Anytime she was stopped for a traffic ticket or was even in the proximity of a policeman, she quaked with fear that they'd know about this Constitution question and how my dad had bullied the judge. When I took her to Scotland, she asked me, "Will I be able to get back in?" "Ma, don't, Ma, this is 60 years ago. They don't know that you said boat." "Well, you know, sometimes just to get..." "Ma, you're a citizen. The passport says you're a citizen of the United States." "Oh, but those lawyers..." It never ended. This went on until the day she died. My mother couldn't marry my father until she learned how to cook Italian. It was some strange Leno bylaw. But once she figured out how to successfully water down tomato paste, she was fine. The marriage flourished for 57 years. She first met my dad in New York at a party. Up until then, she'd been dating an amateur wrestler. And, of course, my father was always very scrappy and even trained to become a bantamweight boxer. Apparently, this wrestler was going to be at the same party. My father was ready for a confrontation. Showing off for Mom, he said, "I'll beat the hell out of the guy." Then the guy came in, and he was just huge, like a behemoth. My dad took one look at him and said to my mom, "How many times did you go out with him?" "A couple of times." "Well, I guess that's okay. Looks like a nice guy." According to family history, a whole bunch of Lenos came to America on a boat at the turn of the century. Some of them stayed in New York and settled in the Bronx or New Rochelle. The others went on to Canton, Ohio. In general, Italians back then either sold fruits and vegetables or they became barbers. The barbers landed in Ohio. My grandfather was a tiny man, had a produce wagon in New York where he peddled his goods all over town. One time, my dad hid in the back of the wagon and secretly rode along into one of the outer boroughs. Somehow, he fell off the wagon and couldn't get back on. Because there were no telephones, he had no way of getting word back home. So he ended up staying with a nice family for 3 or 4 days, during which time my grandfather pushed his cart into every neighborhood hollering, "Angelo! Angelo, where the hell are you?" Finally, he found my dad, and when he did, he gave a big hug and then beat the hell out of him, kind of a warm, happy ending Italian style. My clearest memory of my Italian grandparents is that I never knew what they were talking about. My grandmother spoke no English at all, just what sounded like gibberish to a kid. The only words I could ever make out were, "Jamie, good boy, here's a dollar." You know, to me, a grandparent was somebody who yammered unintelligibly, whether in Yiddish or Italian or Polish or whatever. Grandparents did not speak English. I was almost a teenager before I met anyone's grandparents who did. I remember saying to the kid, "Are these your real grandparents?" He said, "Yeah." I said, "But they speak English. How could they be grandparents?" You know, I'm probably most like my father in demeanor. The only difference is I don't have a temper. My dad had a great temper. He never directed towards the family so much as anyone else who might have provoked him. I didn't let go of things easily. To this end, perhaps the most defining incident of his life took place when he was about 13. This was in the Bronx during the Depression. He had been sent with a few dollars to buy groceries for Grandma. He got as far as the corner when a gang of 7 kids jumped him and took his money. Of course, my father was humiliated. Losing the money was the worst thing that could happen, so he swore revenge. Right away, he started going down to a gym to build up his muscles and learn how to box. Eventually, he became a very tough amateur prize fighter, and that's when he decided it was time to find the 7 guys who humiliated him. Over the course of the next few years, he managed to track down and punch the lights out of 6 of them, but he could never find the 7th guy. Apparently, the guy moved away or something. This drove my dad nuts. So much he never gave up searching. Never. I mean, to the point where, and I swear this is true, at age 83 on his deathbed, he called me close and said, "That 7th guy, that son of a bitch, I never found that guy." And I guess I inherited some of this tenacity from him. Even though I'm not much of a fighter, I did, however, promise him, "I'll try to find the 7th guy, Dad," because he'd be in his late 90s by now, and I'm sure I could probably take him. My dad was an insurance man most of his life. It was a perfect job for him. He was always very gregarious, a good people guy, great salesman. Before that, he had worked such jobs as turning over Coke bottles at a Coca-Cola factory and driving a truck. Then his older brother John got him hired at Prudential Insurance, where my dad worked until he retired. Uncle John was the only Leno at that point to have gone to college, a privilege given to the oldest boy in most immigrant families. His degree got him the Prudential job, and right away he knew my dad had the ideal street smarts to push policies door to door. So when my dad started there, he said, "What's the toughest area?" The other salesman said, "Harlem, Spanish Harlem. Those people don't care about insurance." But my dad said, "Oh yeah? Well, I'll go up there." Although he never had any trouble, he would tell funny stories about how the big thing in Harlem at that time was to rob the insurance man. Robbers would always take the insurance guy's pants or clothes so he wouldn't run into the street yelling for police. At conventions, unfailingly, there would be jokes about the five naked insurance guys stuck in the Harlem stairwell. But my dad always liked working in Harlem. For a street guy, he was never ever heard to utter an ethnic or racial slur. He hated any type of prejudice. In fact, not long ago, I got a letter from a woman who wanted to know if my dad might have been the same Mr. Leno who would come around every week to collect a nickel from her family. Nickel policies were common for people who didn't have big incomes. Apparently, he always brought candy for the children and would often be invited in for dinner. This woman remembered waiting for him every week and said he was really the first white person she ever knew. Eventually, he worked his way up the ranks and became the Andover office manager, where he won all kinds of sales awards for his division. Because he was a funny guy, he was often asked to speak at the insurance convention. I remember seeing him working on jokes, writing them on big yellow pads. I was always fascinated to see where he'd cross out certain phrases depending on what the audience would be like. Like, if there were religious people there, he'd change a line like, "And they ran like hell," to "They ran like blazes." And if he was accepting some accolade, he would always use me in his speech to say, "My boy just said to me, 'They can't mean you, Dad,'" which was mortifying to me. Afterwards, I'd say to him, "I didn't say that," and he'd laugh. Years later, when I began telling stories about him, he'd call me and say, "I never said that," and I'd say, "Well, you used to do it to me, now we're even." He thought that was the funniest thing he ever heard. By the time he retired, Dad was the last of the old breed of insurance men. Certainly, he was one of the last guys who'd risen in the company without the benefit of formal education. All of those great Italian street salesmen were gone, but he always kept up with the ongoing changes in the industry. There were moments, though, that the new breed of insurance punks gave him grief, and my dad could only take so much grief. I remember when he was about 63, he came home from work and complained about one particular union guy who'd come by his office and behave obnoxiously. The union guy couldn't have been more than 30, but he did a lot of unnecessary finger-poking and hollering. My dad couldn't stand him. He would say, "Oh, this guy is so annoying. What a son of a bitch!" Finally, the old prize fighter inside him couldn't take any more, and he said, "I'm going to fight this guy." So at the age of 63, my dad started training. He'd go running every day. Then he'd work out with a speed bag. After about a month, the union guy showed up again. My father invited him into the office, where the guy launched into his yelling routine. My dad started to holler back, and then suddenly, bam! My dad just dexed the guy, broke his nose. Like any bully, the union guy said, "You son of a bitch, I'm getting the cops," and he ran out of the building. At this point, my dad would pull out his extra-thick glasses and put both the hearing aids in both ears. Then he sat back at his desk and waited. The union guy returned with an Andover policeman. "What happened here, Mr. Leno? Did you beat up this man?" My father squinted through his glasses, turned a hearing aid toward the cop, and said, "What? I'm retiring in 2 years. What the hell am I going to fight a guy half my age? He slipped on the floor. I saw him. He fell down on his face." Of course, the union guy was fuming. "I didn't fall down on my face. The guy beat me up." So the cop took a long look at both of them and asked the union guy, "How old are you, son?" "30. The guy said, 33. My dad said, "I'm 63. Then the cop started laughing at him. This just infuriated the guy, who stormed out of the office. My dad and the cop just kept on laughing. College was always a mystery to me. It was something I was supposed to do, something my parents wanted me to do, and something I had no idea how to do. But there was a war on, which is another good reason to seek some kind of higher learning. Unfortunately, my high school grade point average couldn't have been lower. It's like a festival of Fs, placing my learning potential on the scale somewhere between intelligence-impaired and hapless moron. For some ridiculous reason, I don't know why, I entered the Bentley School of Accounting and Finance, which seemed like a solid pursuit, even though I had no idea what anybody there was ever talking about. Being somewhat dyslexic, I'd usually see numbers backwards, which, of course, would make for wonderful profit-loss statements. But they accepted my money, and suddenly I was trapped in the wrong place. It didn't last long. I remember sitting in some math class that I was flunking miserably. The professor was rambling on about something or other, and he asked me a question that completely eluded me. I jolted away from my perpetual nap, thinking, how can I get out of this? I said, I got a question for you. I always wondered about math, the whole concept of it. So who's the person responsible? The professor just glared at me and said, "Mr. Leno, your time-wasting techniques are growing very tiresome.
Why don't you just get out right now? I didn't think you knew the answer to my question anyway. So I next set my sights on Emerson College, an esteemed Boston school that specialized in theatrical and communication arts. I figured this was as good a place as any to prepare to become a comedian. Of course, they wanted nothing to do with me either. Emerson's dean of admissions looked at my dismal high school record and literally burst out laughing. This wasn't necessarily a bad thing, since I told him, this is what I want to do, make people laugh for a living. But he wasn't amused.
Your grades don't indicate that you have much incentive, he told me. You really know what we're looking for.
But I didn't give up. I stalked this guy. For the next 3 days, I would sit outside his office from 8 in the morning until he went home at 5. Finally, the end of the day, he said, do you really want to go here? I said, yes. So he heaved a big sigh. He said, all right, take some summer school courses. I said, great, how much is that? He said, $1,200, thinking maybe that would intimidate me. Luckily, I had a lot of dough in those days from my summer jobs and whatnot, so I pulled out $1,200 in a big wad and said, here you go. The guy looked at me and said, okay, you're in. And that was pretty much the extent of my college entrance program. I think the dean must have thought it was like a mobster or something. Not that it helped my grades, but yeah, I probably should have tipped him. One of my first courses at Emerson College was television production, where I was supposed to learn the basics of broadcasting. On the first day of class, I knew something was peculiar. The teacher began by saying things like, are you all familiar with Dan Rather, the newsman? Well, he got his big break covering a hurricane, and he had to go on camera immediately and start reporting the story. In the broadcast field, any one of you could be called upon to broadcast at any time, even if you're not regular on-air talent. There might be an emergency. And, of course, you always need to look your best. It's very important. With that, he started handing out these Max Factor makeup kits. All right, the first thing I want you to do is practice putting on makeup. We opened up these kits, and he moved around the room, giving little tips. Okay, good, Bob. Try a little more foundation. He was dabbing us with an eyebrow pencil and helping the girls apply lipstick. Suddenly the whole class looked like the road company of La Cage aux Folles. I had a hard time believing Dan Rather ever did this before a hurricane. And if he did, wouldn't the hurricane pretty much have obliterated the makeup? Still, I was glad we were covering these hard-hitting fundamentals of broadcast. I often said the reason I chose Emerson was because most of the exams were oral. I could give a talk instead of taking a test, which I figured would tremendously improve my chance of not flunking. This didn't exactly hold true. My grades were terrible anyway. Then one semester, something amazing happened. As part of the liberal tenor of the times, Emerson decided to try a progressive idea. For this particular semester, students were instructed to grade themselves. That is, we could give ourselves a grade we thought we deserved. Well, I was thrilled. This, I thought, is my opportunity. My ship has come in. I've never gotten an A in my life. So for every course, I gave myself an A. Not an A+, not an A-, just A's across the board. It was beautiful. Next thing I knew, I was on the dean's list. I proudly brought the semester report home to my dad, who beamed. I knew you could do it. I knew my boy could do it. Well, thanks, Pop. Took a lot of hard work. He started telling everybody he knew. Look at this, straight A's, my son. And they said he'd never get into college. Straight A's. People from his office were calling me. Congratulations, your father's so proud of you. Well, it took a lot of hard work, I said. Then, of course, the next semester came around. I was back to my usual D's and F's. Sadly, I brought that report card home, too. My father looked at it and said, what the hell do you do here? I don't know, Dad. I know what happened. But he got straight A's last time. Yeah, I know, Papa. It was harder this year. And because he never really grasped how these things work, he would insist on signing the report card. I told him, Dad, this is college. You don't have to sign it. Well, how will the teacher know I saw it? Dad, they don't care if you see it. Anyway, he would sign it and mail it back to the school. Apparently, humiliation can be a repeat offense. I remember I heard about a strange new business in Boston that sold term papers. This made perfect sense to me. Why write a term paper when you could buy one? They could recreate any kind of report imaginable. So I went down there often and asked them how much a term paper cost. The guy said, what kind of grade do you want? I said, look, I'm a conscientious guy. I want to be a good student. I'd like an A. The guy said, an A would be $100. And for another $10, they would type up a beautiful title page with my name, the teacher's name, the course number, just to kind of legitimize the whole thing. So I paid the price, figuring, hey, money well spent, got my paper, turned it in. Week later, I'm sitting in class, staring out the window as usual, with a disgusted expression. The teacher began to pass back the graded term papers. This class has not applied itself, she groaned. These term papers are uniformly terrible, but quite frankly, there is one exception. I'm pleasantly surprised by the efforts of one student, Jay Leno. Jay, your paper was excellent. You get an A. I'm actually swelling with pride. I said, well, thank you. Thank you very much. This is unbelievable to me. A little too unbelievable, it turned out. Later in class, I'm staring out the window half asleep, still feeling like a genius. Suddenly, his teacher says, Jay, let me ask you about hotel-motel management. Seemed like an odd topic to cover in a writing class. I said, me? Jay, why don't you tell us what you know about hotel-motel management? Me? Hotel-motel management? I don't know anything about it.
You have no interest in it? No. I don't know anything about it. I couldn't care less. It's not something I'm interested in. With that, she ran over, grabbed my term paper, ripped it to bits. Well, you wrote a term paper about it, and you got an A. I did? Oh, yeah, right. Well, you just got an F. Get out! Oh, what an idiot I was. I didn't even read the paper I bought. I just handed it in. Folks, it's a valuable lesson learned the hard way. From now on, better to get an F and save $110. During my first year at college, I lived in a small dormitory where I met a very funny guy named Gene Bronstein. He now lives in Los Angeles where he writes television comedy, and we still talk all the time. Back then, we quickly discovered our mutual love for comedians and became instant friends. In the dorm, we started writing bits together, which we would try out in local coffee houses. I think I was drawn to Gene as a comedy partner because he sounded like Dick Cavett, very wry and smart, perfect straight man, as opposed to me. Apparently, see, I was like the loud guy. Anyway, these coffee houses where we worked were very much of that era, post-beatnik havens for protesters of every kind. There was the Orson Welles Theater Cafe, the Sword and the Stone, Cafe Wa in New York, the Nameless Coffee House in Harvard Square. That was the place where Gene and I debuted our comedy act. We billed ourselves as Gene and Jay's unique and original comedy. That night, as always, we followed some angry guy reading poems that invariably seemed to end with the same line, "Stop your war machine!" The audience would hoot, "Woo! Yeah!" And the poet would gush, thank you, ladies and gentlemen." It was all very incongruous. But it got even more incongruous when we took the stage. For the first time ever, Gene and I performed a bit we called The Lone Arranger. The stupid premise was simple enough. Tonto goes to the bank, take out a loan. I played Tonto. It went like this.
Me want loan.
Yes, sir, I'm the Lone Arranger.
You Lone Ranger?
No, the Lone Arranger.
Lone Ranger?
No, Lone Arranger. I arranged the loan. It was that bad. But it was our first time. Not 3 minutes into it, a woman in the audience screamed at us, "You're being cruel and insensitive to Native Americans. Many Native Americans suffer under the hands of oppression." So this just stopped us cold. I said, "Lady, it's a bit about the Lone Ranger and Tonto." "Yes, but by making fun of Tonto, you're making fun of all Native Americans." I said, "It's a guy going for a loan. The joke is not the Indian. It's a mistaken idea. It doesn't matter." You know, suddenly my first gig in comedy had turned into a civil rights rally. Later, however, we just changed a bit and had Tonto say things like, "Nixon, what a jerk! Stop your war machine! Thank you, good night!" It wasn't any funnier, but the applause was tremendous. Of the two of us, Gino was more like the hippie guy. He loved the psychedelic music and enjoyed smoking a little dope every now and then. I was kind of the clean-cut guy. I somehow missed the urge to get stoned. It just wasn't something I was into. To this day, my total alcoholic consumption is still about half a glass of beer. I can't even eat rum cake. I always felt I was losing my edge if I got high. Although old photographs might suggest otherwise, like everybody else, I had long hair and wore these kind of dopey wire-rimmed granny glasses, big vest, and this stupid snap-brimmed hat. To affect a sophisticated air in college, I even took up pipe smoking, which probably made me look even dorkier. But as with most teams, our differences work well together. In my second year at Emerson, we moved off campus to an apartment on Commonwealth Avenue. About that time, I remember we went to see the movie Joe, in which Peter Boyle hates hippies so much he stalks them with a gun. And this really shook up Gino, whose friends mostly tend to be hippies. Shortly afterwards, in fact, he told me that a few of his friends from back home were coming to visit and would be staying in the apartment. He warned me that they were big dope smokers, which was fine. Everybody in Boston was. But they hadn't yet met me. I thought it'd be hilarious to terrorize them, Joe style. First night they were in the apartment, I knew they'd be hanging out, drinking wine and smoking dope, so I went out and bought a starter's pistol, the kind that sounds like a very loud campfire, you know, to begin track races. I decided to make a dramatic entrance. I waited for my moment, then kicked in the door and shouted, "Hippies!" I assumed the squad position and started firing the pistol. They all left 5 feet in the air. One guy, who was completely stoned, shrieked, "Ah! Ah!" His hair turned white in front of me. Then he climbed behind the couch, crying and sniveling. I walked over, put my hand out, and said, "Hi, I'm Jay, Gene's roommate. Nice to meet you." "Don't kill me, man!" He kept screaming. They all managed to recover somewhat. In fact, they later tried to use the starter pistol as a bong, as I remember. But there is a postscript to this. 18 years after that incident, I bumped into the same guy, Bob, who had climbed behind the couch. He's now a successful businessman, married with kids. I said, "Hi, Bob, remember me?" He said, "Ah! Ah!" Once there were no young comedians. It seems almost unfathomable now. But stand-up comedy had never really been a young man's game. The comedians you saw on the Ed Sullivan Show were middle-aged, primarily Jewish, native New Yorkers, all grown men in nice suits like Alan King and Rodney Dangerfield. Their material tended to speak more to your father than it did to you. Although there would always be the obligatory crumb thrown, "Hey, how about those kids today, huh?" In Boston, there were no comedians at all. At least I never met one. But at that point, there was no such thing as a comedy club either. Looking back, this was probably advantageous to me. Today, new comedians living in Los Angeles have to compete for stage time at clubs with famous names like Jerry Seinfeld and Larry Miller and Robin Williams. No matter how well a new comedian does, He's still going to be overshadowed. It makes it tougher to get noticed. The forerunners of my generation began turning up at the end of the 60s. David Steinberg, George Carlin, Robert Klein. If I had one major influence, it was Klein. His background seemed similar to mine, just a guy raised by a normal middle-class family. His points of reference were the same as mine, current television, pop culture, mass media, and ridiculous details of a young person's everyday life. And this was a revelation to me. Carlin and Steinberg were the same way. In fact, I memorized Carlin's marvelous class clown routine and would run it through my head before making extemporaneous class speeches at Emerson just to jumpstart myself. I'd have his comedic rhythm playing in the back of my head, a proven wonderful rhythm that I would try to emulate. This always worked much better than starting cold. I did, however, stop short of wearing the Carlin ponytail. You know, whenever big comedians came through Boston, Gene Bronson and I always tried to go catch their act. Usually they'd work the Playboy Club and a great club called Paul's Mall, where we saw Flip Wilson, Cheech and Chong, Klein, and David Steinberg. Steinberg even let us interview him for our college radio station and took the time to encourage us. In fact, despite the cutthroat reputation of comedians, I was never discouraged by anybody in the business. Nobody ever said, forget it, get the hell out of here. Except once. I took a part-time job washing dishes at the Boston Playboy Club. I figured this would be my surefire entree into the exciting world of professional show business. The logic was, maybe if I started out with a dishwasher, I could somehow graduate to become the headline comedian in the Playmate Room. Obviously, I was an idiot. This was a terrible job. I worked under Rodney the Cook, an enormous black guy who must have weighed well over 300 pounds. Very jovial, nice guy, but all business. Rodney stepped me up in front of these vast wasp patients piled high with hundreds of filthy plates. I would shoot a sprayer of scalding water at this mountain of plates, plates that never stopped piling up. Every 5 minutes, another 100 plates would come in. And this was a task with no real sense of accomplishment. The minutes felt like hours, and after a few weeks, I had to quit. But I did derive some pleasure from the job. Occasionally, I would stick my head into the showroom to watch comedians. Inevitably, Rodney would catch me and holler, "What are you doing? Get back to work!" During an early break one night, I managed to sneak into the showroom when Rodney wasn't around. It was completely empty. Nobody was in sight. I decided this was my moment. I wanted to go stand on the stage and know what it felt like. I crept up there and stood in front of the mic, which was shut off. I started goofing around, doing pretend patter. "Hey, everybody doing okay? Hey, you look like a great crowd." And that's when I saw the comedian Stewie Stone, who's still working today, step out of the wings. He was the headliner that night, and he looked angry. He shouted, "Hey, what are you doing?" I said, "Oh, hi, I want to be a comedian. I thought I'd..." "Will you get off that stage? That stage is for professional comedians only." Then he went into this long lecture that seemed to go on for an eternity, tore into me. To this day, I'm still not sure whether he was kidding or not, but I took it seriously. You know, when you're starting out in show business, even the smallest, most insignificant slights have monumental consequences. And Stewie Stone's tirade had lasting impact. To this day, whenever I meet someone who's interested in comedy, I always try to encourage him or her. God forbid that kid would later write a book like this. I don't ever want to read. "And Leno told me to get out of the business. That idiot!" Bronstein and I saw an advertisement in the paper that said, "Do you think you're funny? Call this number." It smelled like a dare, so we called. It turned out to be an audition for a comedy troupe with a very unfunny name, Fresh Fruit Cocktail. On a lark, we went down to audition, and amazingly, I was chosen and Gino wasn't. They needed a loud guy, I figured. Ultimately, being part of a group wasn't very satisfying. Some people wanted to work, others didn't. We'd do bits and little improvisations. For the most part, everyone had their own ideas, and there were just too many different kinds of comedy clashing. Still, it was fun while it lasted, which for me was about 6 months. The best part of the whole experience was being booked to play the Playboy Club. Before our first show, Rodney Cook spotted me, and even though months had gone by since I quit, out of reflex, he said, "Hey, get back in the kitchen." I said, "Rodney, I'm working here." "Yeah, shut up. Get back in and watch." I said, "Rodney, I'm headlining. I'm playing here." He didn't believe me. And of course, there are moments during the night's performance when I wish I had listened to him and gotten back and started washing dishes. After leaving Fresh Fruit Cocktail, I decided it was time to create my own act. It was time to be a comedian. Not that I had had that much time between classwork and Emerson, but I knew there were places in New York where comedians could try out material between music acts and more angry poets. One night, I would make the 4-hour drive just to go do it. So I sat down to write my first joke, which was based on my own experiences, which I ended up using for years. For better or worse, and with my apologies, here's the joke. Boston's a big college town. A lot of people think it's very hip, very liberal, very permissive. And it is, in a lot of ways, except one. I go to school there in my dormitory. You can have girls in your room. You can have liquor in your room. You can have drugs in your room 24 hours a day if you want to. Only one thing you're not allowed to have. A hot plate. And one night, not long ago, I went back to my room. My roommate and his girlfriend and her roommate lying on the bed. He's got like 5 joints in his mouth. There's an empty bottle of apple wine on the floor. They're naked and passed out cold. I figure, well, it's quiet. I'll do some studying.
After about 10 minutes, he got hungry, snake out my hot plate, decided to cook some soup. Next thing I knew, he heard a knock at the door. Boom, boom, boom. What's going on in there? Nothing, sir, nothing. You got soup in there? No, sir, all we got in here is liquor and girls and drugs.
Don't lie to me, son. I know you have soup in there.
You gotta start somewhere. So I started a place in Greenwich Village called The Other End, which had previously been the legendary club The Bitter End, and I think is back to being The Bitter End again. Everyone from Lenny Bruce to George Carlin played The Bitter End, which made the adventure even a bigger deal to me. I drove up from Boston for audition night, ready to try out my stuff. The only problem was I had an extremely sore throat, and it hurt to even open my mouth. Somebody backstage handed me a bottle of chloroseptic throat spray and said, "This will help." Pain was so intense, I figured I'd better take an extra dose, so I spritzed my mouth about 10 times. Unfortunately, nobody told me that chloroseptic has a kind of numbing effect that makes your tongue feel thick, like it's encased in cotton. I couldn't even speak intelligibly. So I got up to do my audition, and roughly came out of my mouth was this. Anyway, Ted Lorenz, who ran the club, said, "Well, it sounded like you had some funny stuff, but people can't understand what you're saying. Do you have a lisp or something?"
I said, "No, I can't say clear sentence."
He said, well, why don't you come back next week when you feel better?" The next week, I felt better, and the material seemed to work okay. This time, Ted said, "You know, you did good. Why don't you come back and work a week here for free?" That, of course, is standard policy when you're starting out. And before I left the club, I was approached by a guy who turned out to be a small-time press agent. He said, "Hey, great, you're back next week. You know, you're going to need a PR guy to handle this for you." I said, "What do you mean?" "So you need to get the word out you're going to be here." "Well, that sounded okay to me." He said, "What do I have to do?" He said, "I'll take care of it for you." Following week, I came into the club, which, of course, was empty as ever. Not that I expected anything else. People don't exactly rush out to watch amateurs. But the press agent was waiting for me. He handed me a bill and said, "You owe me $150. I looked at the bill, which said, "Place ad in the Penny Saver, $50. Put up flyers, $25. Representation fee, $75. I said to him, "You never said I have to pay you this much." He started screaming, "Hey, you hired me! You told me to do this!" And then he went to complain to Ted Lorenz. So like an idiot, I just paid him. He took the money and stormed out, saying, "I don't want to be your PR guy anymore anyway." Despite this crushing blow, I went on that night and again managed to do well enough to be asked back again. You know, this was starting to get exciting, so I called my folks and told them the good news. My dad, of course, thrilled that I was doing well in any endeavor, even in stand-up comedy. So unbeknownst to me, he called up all the Italian relatives in New York and said, "Jay's going to be at a club in the Village next week. Go see him." So that night I walked in, as usual, only a handful of people in the audience. I went backstage to wait my turn, and suddenly I heard a big commotion out front. Then I recognized a loud voice saying, "Hey, Jay Leno gonna be here tonight?" It had to be my Uncle Lou, which it was. Peeking out from behind the curtain, I saw him bustling into the room with my 90-year-old grandmother, who spoke no English, as well as my Uncle Mike and his 2 daughters, who were 9 and 12. They all sat down at a table to watch the other acts, some of which were so filthy, you literally had to be a gynecologist to understand what they were talking about. Already I was mortified. Then Uncle Lou started making a ruckus. You know, Lou has always been the great character of the family. A lifelong bachelor, he had kind of a George Raft look, always decked out in a big coat and a fedora. At one point, he even owned racehorses. Now I heard him hollering for a waitress, "I need a scotch and soda here!" She told him all he served was herbal tea. "What the hell is herbal tea? All right, fine, give me an herbal tea!" Meanwhile, some hippie folk guitar player had taken the stage to sing war protest songs. The waitress brought Lou his herbal tea, and he started bellowing, "The hell kind of drink is this?" It was like a nightmare. Ted Lorenz sidled up to me and said, "Who are those people?" Completely embarrassed, I said, "It's my family. They came down to see my debut." Then the folk singer came off stage and complained to Ted. "I thought it was supposed to be a hip place." I said, Yeah, my family. Take it easy. Yeah, they can't help it." Anyway, it was my turn to go on stage and walk on to hear, "Hey, Jay, baby!" My family applauding wildly in contrast to the handful of other customers who couldn't have been less interested. Because every other act in the place just hated me now. Meanwhile, my grandmother, who had no idea even what I was saying, kept saying, Jamie, on at the stage. Somehow I did my act. I don't remember much about it except seeing an angry look on my Uncle Mike's face throughout the whole set. Mike was the most religious member of the family, and I guess my material was a little raw in those days. One particular bad joke was about a new male hygiene spray called Umpire. I said it was made specifically for men with foul balls. Uncle Mike just glowered at me, and then he made my cousins cover their ears for the rest of the show.
just changed a bit from that conversation. He's like, Nixon, what a jerk. Stop your war machine. Thank you. Good night. It wasn't any funnier, but...
Besides comedy, the only thing that ever really interested me was cars and motorcycles. The day I got my first apartment on Commonwealth, I remember noticing a car dealership down the street called Foreign Motors, which sold Rolls-Royces, Mercedes-Benz, and Citroen Maserati. Having already worked at Wilmington Ford and learned all the wonders of Falcons and Galaxies, I saw this as an opportunity for me to move up. So the day after I moved in, I walked over and asked for a job. The sales manager, Sheldon Loring, said he didn't need anybody. I left, but not before getting a glimpse of the bay where the new cars were cleaned and prepped for buyers. The next day, I went back and just started working with the prep guys. I told them, hi, I'm the new guy. What do you want me to do? You know, I used to tell a joke about prepping new cars. I'd say to the audience, you know those floor mats you get when you buy a new car? They have the 2 feet on them. You know how when you pick up the floor mat and there's always grease on the mat underneath? That was my job, to put the grease underneath before putting the nice, clean floor mat. Anyway, a couple of days passed before Sheldon Loring caught sight of me. He said, hey, what are you doing here? I said, I just been working for a couple of days. He said, who hired you? I said, nobody. Then some of the prep guys told him, hey, you know, the kid's doing a good job, which was all it took. Being a car salesman, I think he appreciated this kind of chutzpah, so he hired me right on the spot. And because I was a college student and fairly glib, the bosses would elect me to do the odd errand and interface with the customers. I was the one who drove customers home when they brought cars in for servicing, and I also got to deliver the new Rolls-Royces and Mercedes to the buyer's home. And, of course, these were some of the richest people in Boston. Arthur Fiedler, the legendary Boston Pops conductor, would have his car brought in from time to time. Strange as it may sound, he was fascinated with the fire department. So whenever a fire broke out and he was without his car, I'd be told, Jay, go pick up Arthur Fiedler and take him to the fire. I'd pull up to his house and he would jump in saying, there's a fire in Roxbury! And we'd race to the scene so he could watch the leaping flames. He even had a hat. His eyes would sparkle like a little kid. Eventually, the fire department gave him a siren and flashing lights for his Mercedes. Another task that fell to me was driving the recipients of Harvard's Hasty Pudding Award to the ceremony each year. Because they were visiting celebrities, Harvard wanted them ferried around in style. That's why we had Rolls-Royces. I drove for Liza Minnelli and Faye Dunaway and many others. One year, John Wayne was given the award, and instead of a limousine, he was taken to the event in an army tank. My job was to follow him in a Rolls-Royce in case anything went wrong. Well, nothing did, except for the moment after his speech when he asked the audience a question. Harvard, of course, was a hotbed of radicalism and liberal thinking in those days. Yeah, things have changed a lot. So a woman got up and asked him, what do you think of woman's liberation? John Wayne swaggered as only could and said, I think women's lib is fine, as long as they're home by 6 to cook my dinner. The crowd gave him a thunderous cheer, but the woman, furious, she shrieked, fuck you, John Wayne. Then there was stunned silence. And he just swaggered up the mic and said, well, fuck you, little lady. Got a huge laugh, and I think he needed the tank to get out of there after that. My favorite Hasty Pudding winner was Jack Lemmon, who I picked up at the airport. He was very, very nice to me. We got to talking, and I told him I wanted to be a comedian. He gave me a big smile and said, well, maybe we'll be neighbors in Beverly Hills someday. The best part of this story is we actually are neighbors in Beverly Hills. I think that's what made me buy the house I live in. I get to wave to Jack Lemmon on my way to work every day. He even waves back. There were other benefits of this job. One night I had to deliver Joseph Kennedy's 1954 Rolls-Royce Silver Wraith limousine for the White House. I stopped off and picked up my girlfriend, then drove to a secluded Lover's Lane area where we made love. Made love in the back seat of Joseph Kennedy's Silver Wraith Rolls-Royce. We were parked next to rows of Volkswagens where other couples were cramped and contorted and probably sustaining concussions, but We had a big Rolls Royce. Anyway, we pulled down the shades and the back windows and sprawled out in what I finally remember as kind of the Hyannis Porsec mobile. Eventually, some other people came over from the Volkswagen to ask about the car. I told them it belonged to old man Kennedy. They asked who I was, and thinking fast, I told them I was a Larry Kennedy. I was the brother nobody ever talks about. That's me, Larry Kennedy. Often I would sort of borrow the occasional Rolls Royce and Mercedes for a night. Gene Bronstein and I would then cruise around town trying to impress college girls. We came up with a scam in which I rode in the back seat and Gene drove. At the time, because of my long hair and little glasses, I bore a vague resemblance to English pop star Donovan. So we would pull up next to girls on the street and I'd lower the window. Inevitably, they would say, "Hey, isn't that Donovan?" Gene would say, "Yes, it is. I'm his manager. Would you like to meet him?" Girls would climb in the back seat and I would have my stupid British accent on. "Hello, love. I'm Donovan. How are you, love?" You know, I wonder if Donovan ever knew how well he did for himself in Boston during the early 70s. Some nights after work, I was sent to pick up cars at Rolls-Royce headquarters in Paramus, New Jersey on Route 15. And although I wasn't supposed to, I always drove from there to New York to try and get on at the improv. Every night, I would pull up in a different new Rolls and Mercedes, which would create a huge stir. Bud Friedman, who owns the improv, was convinced I was some ridiculously wealthy young comedian, an impression I enjoyed giving. He had no idea I was driving him to Boston every night. He just thought I was the son of some influential New York capitalist with a massive car collection. This might have been the reason he was so nice to me and always gave me a spot on stage. One night I picked up a Rolls-Royce in Paramus and delivered it to a customer who lived nearby. He paid me $29,500 in cash, which he handed over in a brown paper lunch bag. I went to Paramus to pick up another Rolls and raced to the improv to try and go on for a set. I got there about midnight, and as usual, parked the Rolls on the street near 44th and 9th, where the club was. I still had the $29,000 with me, and I figured I'd better not leave in the car, so I brought it inside the club, clutching it like it was my lunch. Bud told me I could go on about 1:30, so I just held onto the bag until it was my turn. Finally, I went on stage, put the bag on the piano behind me. Because I was going to try out some new material that night, I had my little tape recorder with me, which I placed near the bag and switched on. This way, I could listen back later and gauge how well the stuff went over. As it turned out, there weren't more than 20 people in the audience, but the jokes were killing. I was doing unbelievable. It was one of the best receptions I'd ever gotten, which pumps you up with amazing amounts of adrenaline. By the time I finished, I was soaring. So I grabbed the tape recorder, ran out to the Rolls, and drove off feeling exhilarated. As I sped along, I listened to the tape and heard all of those laughs I'd gotten over and over again. I'd just gone to the toll booth in Greenwich, Connecticut, when it hit me. I don't have $29,000. I left it on top of the piano. By now, some comics are probably spending it on hookers. Like a maniac, I turned around and tore back to New York. At this point, it was almost 4 in the morning. The improv was about to close. I burst inside and saw a girl singing on stage. Behind her was the piano, and on the piano, unbelievably, was still the brown paper bag. So I sneaked up on stage, and the girl gave me an angry look. I pointed the bag and whispered, "My lunch. I forgot my lunch. Sorry." I looked inside, and thank God, the huge wad was still in there. This was the luckiest day in the history of show business. Because I always thought, had that money not been there, I would literally just be getting out of jail now. My whole career never would have happened. First night ever audition at the improv, Freddie Prinze auditioned too, and so did a comedian named Steve Levetkin, who later met an infamous fate when he jumped off the roof of the Hyatt Hotel on Sunset Boulevard next door to the Comedy Store. Early on, I began to see a trend in comedians who eventually self-destructed. In most cases, they were guys trying to use stand-up as a stepping stone for an acting career. They often made the mistake of assuming that comedy would be the easiest part of the progression. They didn't find enough joy in just telling jokes, and they also neglected to put themselves in the place of the audience. They only heard their own voices, and they would ignore the response of the crowd. Countless times I watched someone get virtually no laughs, then ask him afterwards how he thought he'd done, and inevitably they would say, "Oh, I kill!" This phenomenon is called laugh ears, a delusion you hear laughs when in fact there are none. I always believed being a comedian required a certain tenacity, which I was lucky enough to have. To audition at places like Catch a Rising Star in the Improv, we would start lining up outside the clubs at 2 in the afternoon with hopes of getting on stage sometime after 11 that night. You spend your whole day sitting on the curb, waiting and waiting, and inevitably somebody in front of you go, "This sucks," and walk away. I always enjoyed that. All of a sudden, I had moved up. Without doing a thing, my standing in show business had just improved. And this process seemed to encompass my philosophy of life. That's why I originally wanted to call this book A Good Dog Will Run Till His Heart Explodes. It's an old hunting expression I always loved. As a child, one image was drilled into my head and has stayed with me ever since. While I was goofing off or watching TV, Russian kids were studying math. I didn't know if it was true, but it sounded intimidating. So I chose to believe that whenever I was doing nothing, someone else was catching up and taking everything I had. This is what makes vacations agony for me. The point is, any idiot can have a life. If you're breathing, you got a life. But careers are hard to come by. You know, I've never been better at anything than anybody else. It meant I'd always have to work a little harder to try and keep up or maybe even pull ahead. Like Turtle to race the hare, I plowed forward, slow and steady. Even it meant sitting on curbs all day or sleeping on the back steps of comedy clubs all night. In fact, I have vivid memories of sleeping in the alley next to the improv. If there was no place to crash or I was too tired to drive back to Boston, I'd hunker down against a brick wall near Dyke's Lumberyard and try to doze off. I soon learned that prostitutes like to bring guys into the same alley. Some nights I'd wake up to the sounds of sleazy sales pitches or low moaning or worse, somebody getting slapped. I would cower there and feel like Dustin Hoffman, a midnight cowboy. Ironically, Dustin Hoffman was once the house piano player at the improv. I think that's where he got the idea for Rizzo Ratzo in that alley. Spontaneous bedlam occasionally broke out of the improv. There was a nearby strip joint called Broadway Burlesque, and sometimes girls who worked there would come in after work. After a few cocktails, they liked to amuse themselves by taking off their clothes again in our club. Naturally, this also amused all the comedians present. One night during my act, I needed somebody to come on stage to help me do a bit. I picked a young woman in the front row. I didn't realize until later that she'd just gotten off work at Broadway Burlesque. I just knew that whenever I looked away from her, the audience would roar with laughter. I'd think, well, it can't be me. I haven't said anything funny yet. Then I found out she'd been flashing the crowd behind my back. On another night, I was working as MC, and when one woman came on stage totally naked, the crowd went batty. Bud Friedman ran around locking the doors to prevent a vice raid. Then another girl screamed, her body's terrible, whereupon she took her clothes off just to challenge the first naked woman. Suddenly, everybody in the club was undressing, partially or completely. I think I ended up my underwear, which seemed to have a sobering effect on the room. You know, you always leave them wanting more. Because there was no money to be made in the open mic clubs, comedians were often paid with food. I learned there was a pecking order at most of these places. As one club owner explained it, the opening act could have any of the sandwiches from the vending machine out back. The middle act could have any one of the appetizers on the menu. And the headliner could have any of the entrees except steak or roast beef. When I headlined for that owner, I asked, can I give the opening act my potatoes? He looked stricken and said, no, you can't do that. There's no sharing. If you do, then everybody's going to give the opening act their potatoes. You'll ruin it for everybody. At the improv, I always loved MC because Bud gave me free run of the menu. One night I ate 5 sirloin steaks, which quickly put an end to my free run of the menu. But some people had a hard time understanding these cryptic club policies. For example, early on in the improv days, my father asked me, hey, how's the comedy thing going? I said, good, Pop, good. I'm going down to New York a lot. What's that nightclub you pay? The improv? What does that fella pay you down there? He doesn't pay anything, Dad. What do you mean he doesn't pay anything? He doesn't pay anybody, Dad. He charges people to get in? Yeah. He charges for the drinks? Yeah. What the hell is that? He's making money off of you? You tell him your father says you're supposed to get a couple of bucks. Dad, I'm not going to tell him that. Look, then I'll tell the son of a... Get him on the phone right now. You're not working for free. Dad, don't call him on the phone. It's showbiz. It's the way it's worked. He worked for free. He's taking advantage of you. I suppose he had a point, but hey, that's how show business works. That, however, was probably the night I think I ate the 5 steaks. The most exciting rite of passage to witness was whenever a comedian whom we knew got a shot on national television. This was an amazing phenomenon, to actually know somebody on TV. One by one, we saw guys go forth and do it. The great neurotic comic Richard Lewis was the first from our graduating class, so to speak, to make the cut. By then, I had already been in awe of Lewis. On my first night at the improv, I'd seen a copy of the Bergen County News with a story about local comic Richard Lewis. Then I turned around and actually met Lewis. I couldn't get over this. I was practically starstruck. A guy that had been in the newspaper. Very early on, Lewis had done a Tonight Show, after which he came back to New York to wait for the next big break, which came shortly thereafter. In those days, TV variety show producers would come to the improv to scout talent. Sonny Bono, who was running the Sonny and Cher Comedy Hour, dropped in all the time. Of course, the room would buzz with anticipation, which must have been a new sensation for Sonny. One night, he must have spotted Lewis. The next thing we knew, they were flying him to California to do the show. This was unbelievable. One of our own was going to do his act on primetime television. And of course, mixed in with a bit of natural envy, we're all rooting for him. Lewis called us from there to tell us when the show would air. So that night, all the comedians collected down at the improv, where we all huddled at the bar to watch the show at 8 o'clock. Everybody fell quiet, waiting for Rich's shot. At some point, Sonny and Cher were involved in a sketch set in a vegetable garden. We were paying half attention when suddenly we spotted Lewis dance by in the background, dressed as a lettuce leaf. Another guy was a carrot. Human vegetables now spinning around all over the place. We were stunned. also on the floor laughing. Knowing Lewis, he had to be humiliated. Rather than showing off his crackling wit, he had been reduced to being a dancing piece of lettuce. Well, we called him right away, passing the phone around, saying, "Hey, great shot! Hey, boy, it really made that lettuce look good. Hey, green is your color!" Strange enough, vegetable or not, it was still very exciting. Of any of us, Andy Kaufman was by far the most innovative comedian at that time, although he never liked being called a comedian. Clearly, he was the oddest act. Most of us thought he was very funny, but we worried that no one else would get him. We even felt sort of sorry for him because he was so untraditional. Of course, his great success proved us wrong. Still, he never told any jokes. He just behaved strangely in order to get a reaction, any kind of reaction, even hostile. There were nights he'd catch a rising star when he'd lay on stage in a sleeping bag. Other nights, he would just read endless passages from The Great Gatsby in his monotonous voice. Or he would become the foreign man character who spoke flurries of gibberish before turning into Elvis Presley doing an astonishingly accurate impersonation. At that time, shocking though it may seem now, I also did an Elvis bit in which I'd sneer a lot and sing Shakespeare soliloquies, as the king might have. I also sung Lou Christie falsetto, then thankfully my voice changed. But Andy and I enjoyed our Elvis kinship. A few years later, Dick Clark told me that he heard Elvis himself was a fan of only two Elvis impersonators, Andy's and mine. Anyway, as it turned out, Andy was also commuting to New York from Boston, where he too attended college. So he often ended up driving down with me, although I can't say I got to know him very well. With Andy, you never knew who you were talking to. He liked to disappear into different personas off stage as well as on stage, and refused to ever break character. One character he liked to become was a very sleazy, obnoxious lounge singer named Tony Clifton. Tony was Andy's alter ego, just a horrible person who demeaned audiences and hated him in turn. As Tony, he would hide beneath layers of grotesque makeup, an enormous bad toupee, and a mustache. And he would never acknowledge that he was Andy Kaufman. I'd always approach him and say, "Hey, Andy!" And he would glower back and say, "I don't know who Andy is. Been using my name to get places." As a small point of pride, I may be the only person who ever got him to drop character. One day, I decided to appeal to him in a way I thought would provoke any comedian. I told him, somebody had stolen his act. I said, "Hey, Tony, when you see Andy, tell him I saw a guy last night in another club doing the whole Tony Clifton bit. Mean-spirited, bad singing, everything. It was unbelievable." Suddenly, Tony's eyes turned into Andy's eyes, and they were full of panic. Then from under the makeup, I heard Andy say, "What guy? Where'd you see this guy?" I cracked up. "Ha, gotcha, Andy," I said, "gotcha." I think he then tried to explain that he actually was Tony doing an impersonation of Andy, even though he still said he had no idea who Andy was. He was a remarkable guy, Andy Kaufman, but basically confusing to spend any time around. Cruise directors for the big ocean liner companies would often turn up at the improv recruiting comedians if we were rogue sailors. We were being shanghaied. They'd come in and holler, "I got a 3-day cruise to nowhere. All passengers from Long Island. Job pays $75 for 2 shows, plus accommodations. Who wants it?" Hey, all the comedians would scramble for the job. It was like a bad movie scene. Comedians waved their hands in the air, desperate to go seafaring. The cruise guy would survey the room and say, "I'll pick 2 men. I'll take that man and that one." Then the chosen ones would disappear for days, then return with tales of free food and club med girls they dated. It all sounded quite exotic. But I confess, I was always a tad leery of cruise gigs. The notion of being trapped for days at sea with the audience horrified me, because if you did well, 400 people would be patting you on the back all week. But if you did poorly, they would hate you and let you know whenever they saw you. I was tempted only once. One day, a cruise director showed up with an interesting proposition. He announced, "I've got a cruise, 4 days to the Caribbean. I need a good comedian." I guess he'd seen my act and liked it, because he approached me first. He said, "How'd you like to take the job? Boat leaves Saturday, and the pay is $500 for 2 shows. $500? This was considerably more than the usual $75 everybody else got. Unfortunately, that Saturday, I was booked at a small upstate gig in New York that only paid $50. But I thought it'd be unprofessional to cancel on short notice. Still, I was intrigued. I said, "Gee, I don't know. I got this thing. I'm talking $500. I said, "I know, but how come this one pays so much more?" "Different kind of cruise, different group. They got more money." "What group is it?" I said. "I don't know. You want it or not?" I did, but I couldn't take it. Kind of dismayed with my own principles, I told him, "Look, I can't get out of another gig." "All right, the hell with these, head. I'll get somebody else." So the cruise guy went over to another comic who instantly agreed to go. I don't remember his name, but I believe he never worked again after this job. In fact, I'll never forget the story he told me when he got back. Upon boarding the ship, he went directly to his stateroom and fell asleep. About 2 hours out of port, he woke up to the sounds of wild laughter on the deck. He looked out the porthole and saw a naked guy run by. Well, this was alarming enough. Then there was a knock at his cabin door. and there stood another completely naked guy who told him,
"You're on in an hour."
The comic was stunned. He said, "What's going on here? You're naked." The naked guy said, "Didn't they tell you? This is a gay nude cruise, and you're the entertainment."
By now, the comic feared for his life. Fully dressed, he left his stateroom and walked along the deck, which was populated with hundreds of drunken naked men frolicking and playing volleyball and sipping tropical drinks. Somehow he got to the stage to do his act. But before he could even open his mouth, the all-naked crowd screamed, "Take off your clothes! Take off your clothes!" I don't know if he kept his clothes on or not. All he told me was he locked himself in the stateroom until the ship returned to port. For the rest of the cruise, nude guys would bang on the door every 2 minutes going, "Comedian, come out and get naked! Woo!" I think he spent the entire $500 on therapy. I was once sucked into a nightmare in a similar fashion. A pharmaceutical entrepreneur came to the improv in search of a comic to entertain potential buyers. I was the comic he selected. He told me he was assembling a conference room full of Liggett Rexall dealers in a midtown hotel where he would introduce a new product. Well, it sounded simple enough, and the pay was $75, which was even better. But somehow he neglected to tell me what the product was, and I wasn't especially interested in finding out. Hey, $75 is $75. On the appointed day, I went to the hotel function room where about 60 area Liggett Rexall dealers were waiting this big sales spiel. But first, the entrepreneur took me aside and said, "Look, I got an idea. You pretend to be Bob Johnson, my director of sales. Just talk for a few minutes and then go into your comedy routine. Then when they're all laughing, I'll stand up and I'll tell them who you really are." Well, it's fine with me. So he started the proceedings. "Ladies and gentlemen, I have an exciting new product that will change the habits of American hygiene. The product is called Freshen, which we've imported from Japan. Freshen is a soft, moist towelette on a roll that should be used after bowel movements to avoid embarrassing rectal odor." Now the crowd began to kind of shift uncomfortably. "Freshen is already a sensation in Japan," he said. "And I know you'll see that it becomes a staple in every American bathroom. But before I show you the product, let me introduce you to my director of sales, Bob Johnson. Bob, come out here and talk to these nice people." You know, I was just walking in the lion's den. These Rexall people were appalled. I could see them squirming in their seats, itching to leave, before another mention of the disgusting Freshen product could be made. I had neither the material nor the experience to distract them from this thing. But it was a gig, so I tried. "Hi, my name's Bob Johnson, director of sales. Hope you all enjoy the product." Nothing else to say, certainly not about rectal odor. This is the first I heard of it. So I just launched into my usual act, which now somehow seemed incongruous. "Hey, been to McDonald's?" and so on. The Rexall people just stared numbly and started squirming in silence. Just death. I was supposed to be on for half an hour, but since there was virtually no pauses for laughter, I was done in like 15 minutes. I sat down to no applause. The pharmaceutical guy quickly took the microphone, sweating bullets. He said, "That was not Bob Johnson, director of sales, but of course Jay Leno, a professional comedian." He applauded as if to start some kind of wave that would never, ever come. A Rexall guy down front muttered, "Yeah, that guy's real professional, all right." Anyway, he pushed on with the pitch. "So, now who wants to be the first to sign up for Freshen? I'm going to do something rare here. If you take the first 100 cases, I'll throw in a case of Freshen free for yourself and your family. What do you folks think of that?" No one uttered a word. Now the guy started perspiring. "Let me show you the product." Now the crowd looked horrified, thinking he was about to give an actual demonstration of this disgusting thing. He took out a Freshen sample, which was basically just a big, wet roll of toilet paper mounted on a plastic holder that adhered to the bathroom wall with stickum. "You place the holder right beside the regular toilet paper dispenser where it can be easily reached. That way it becomes second nature to wipe the rectal area once business is done." You know, this is like the most horrible thing I'd ever seen. People now getting up and leaving. He caught one guy and began to plead, "Sir, tell you what, to take a case home, try it with your family. Believe me, I think they're going to love it." The guy shook loose and said, no thanks. I guess the unspoken presumption, of course, was that everybody in the room experienced embarrassing rectal odor. I guess it was just a little too insulting to hear, because suddenly, half the people were bolting. At this point, the man who hired me actually began to cry. He went, "Look, I beg you, look, I got 300,000 cases of this stuff in a warehouse in Jersey. Just take it, just try it, try it in your store. I've invested my whole life in this. Just see if you like it. Believe me, the people will come back, they'll buy it." Now, this is more embarrassing than rectal odor. Now everyone is leaving. Suddenly, I'm alone with a guy who's hunched over, crying to himself, his head cradled in his arms. Finally, walked over and tapped him on the shoulder and said, "Can I have my $75?
He looked at me, tears covering his face. Get out of here, professional comedian. You stink. You ruined my whole presentation. You got no laughs. You're getting the money. Get out. Leave me alone. You know, the guy was so upset. I felt bad. I didn't want to argue with the guy. I said, look, can't you just give me my standing for a buck? No. He said, take a case of freshen if you want. Which I did. I took what I thought was about $75 worth of moist rectal towelettes. Not exactly a dream barter, but hey, deal's a deal. In the 70s, the moment came for every comic. You had to risk it all and go west. A New York career can only take you so far. I watched a number of my peers from the improv make the big decision to try their luck in California. Some were better than me, and some were worse. But we were all pretty much in the same class. On any given night, any one of us could have done better than the other. Some of them just got that burning in the gut feeling and knew it was time for them to seek their fame and fortune. One guy I knew had just left New York for California, and within a few months, pow, he was booked in the Tonight Show, the pinnacle of show business for any comedian. That night, I was back in my Boston apartment watching the show, and the comic did okay. Nothing special, but there he was, performing 10 feet away from Johnny Carson. I thought, you know, I often did better than this guy when we played clubs together. I couldn't shake the thought. I said, that's it. I gotta get out of here. You know, I always said the worst thing you can do in show business is make $30,000 a year by doing something else to support yourself. I'd already quit my job at Foreign Motors to focus on comedy. Now it was time to make the big decision. If I stayed in Boston, I would have wanted a nicer apartment and a better car, and then suddenly I'd be stuck there, married to these possessions. You know, in such a pivotal moment, you either stay or you go. So I simply imagined that, hey, let's say there'd been a fire in my apartment, which wasn't far from the reality, what a dump it'd become. What would I have really lost? So, sometime before the Tonight Show ended that night, I said, that's it. Let me call the airlines, book the next flight to California, which is what I did. I told the neighbors they could take anything of mine that they wanted. I packed up whatever else I needed. I just walked out the door. That was it. I went west. Then I landed at Los Angeles International Airport. And I realized I had no place to stay. You know, sometimes a spontaneity thing can be a little overrated. I hopped in a cab and told the driver the only destination I could even think of. I said, take me to the Sunset Strip. I figured this would be the Los Angeles equivalent of Times Square or Boston's Kenmore Square, the one area where everything was happening. We pulled out of LAX, and I got my first impression of L.A., a strip joint with a huge sign that said, Nudes from 7 a.m. 7 a.m. I imagine guys going in there at 7 in the morning, seeing a naked woman on stage, hair in curlers, cooking eggs for the kids. Billy, get on the bus! Stop hitting your sister! I thought, well, I'm not in Andover anymore. Anyway, $50 later, the cab dropped me off at Sunset in Vermont. This was technically still the Sunset Strip, but roughly 10 miles east of where I wanted to go. Where I wanted to go was to the Comedy Store in West Hollywood, and somehow I managed to get there. Then I remembered that my friend Billy Braver, another comic, lived in an apartment complex right across the street. I lugged my bags over there, and he let me stay at his place and said I could crash in his couch. The first thing I did was go look out of his enormous plate glass window. I wanted to glimpse Hollywood in all its glory. The window faced across a courtyard and a pool towards the corresponding apartments directly on the other side of the complex. And there, staring back at me from the window of the opposite apartment, was Joey Ross, the legendary Officer Tootie of Car 54, Where Are You? He was completely naked. Now, this was not a guy whom you ever wanted to picture naked, much less see for yourself. And I thought, so this is Hollywood, glamour capital of the world. Boy, what is wrong with this picture? After the initial shock of that introduction, Joey Ross was the first Hollywood star to become my friend. A former vaudeville player, he loved all the young comedians, loved to tell us old stories, and most of all, loved prostitutes. So it only followed that his greatest joy was to regale us with tales of hookers he had known. Tales of times he couldn't get it up, how various hired women helped him solve the problem. You know, I'd cover my ears and go, Joey, I'm not interested in this, please. I don't want to hear these details. Stop. He died not long after I met him, but his funeral was one of the great experiences of my life. I think every veteran hooker in town showed up at Forest Lawn. These were women in their 50s who wore fishnet stockings and leopard skin bustiers. According to tradition, the rabbi presiding over the service asked whether any of the mourners wished to say a few words about Joey. And, of course, most of the prostitutes wanted to share their memories. The first one got up and said, Joey always paid. He always paid. Other guys, you'd blow him and they'd stiff you. But Joey, even if he couldn't get it up, he always gave you money. He was a class act. And of course, the rabbi, horrified, realized what a huge mistake he'd made, opening the door for these touching testimonials. But it just got better. The next woman stepped forward and began a story about how she was once performing oral sex on Joey while he was driving. Somehow her head got caught in the steering wheel and wedged against the horn ring. The horn started blowing, beep,
beep, beep. As she struggled to get loose, the cop pulled them over, and with her head stuck in his lap, the cop screamed at Joey, which kind of brought a new meaning to the term moving violation. Apparently, somewhere along the line, Joey had once married a woman with a glass eye, and she was also there that day. She obviously still cared for him deeply because she cried the whole time, and this made for a wonderfully odd spectacle. Tears seemed to stream down from her only good eye, which she covered with her hand, but she left the glass eye exposed, which just stared blankly out at everybody present, never even moving, never blinking. Later, as we all wandered up past the casket, she would extend her free hand in greeting, still sobbing into the other hand. When she shook her hand, the glass eye just stared at us. Very strange situation, but you know, I think Joey would have loved it. The first Los Angeles joke I ever came up with summed up my earliest sentiments about life westward. I always lived on the East Coast. I can't get used to California. Out here, the beach is on the wrong side. Stupid, but sort of true. There were things that took some getting used to, things that made no sense to me. During my first week, I walked around California a lot. One day, I passed a house on Gower where a yard sale was going on, and I realized the man who was unloading his old possessions was the famous comedy magician Carl Ballantyne, you know, from McHale's Navy. I thought to myself, this guy's on TV, he's on McHale's Navy, and he's selling his stuff. How am I going to make it in this town? This is hopeless. From the start, I was homeless in Los Angeles, relying on the kindness of other comics. Among them was Freddie Prinze, who let me sleep on his couch for a couple of nights. Or I'd work out at the Comedy Store and then sleep on the back steps afterwards. Sometimes I'd get on to Hollywood Boulevard and wander around aimlessly at night. More than once, police cars stopped and the cops pulled me over, mistaking me for a drug dealer. I'd get in the backseat of the squad car and explain it was a comedian. So you're a comedian, huh? Why don't you tell us some jokes? Apparently even the cops held show business auditions in Hollywood. So I do part of my act in the backseat throughout the rest of the shift. They drive me around all night. This was, of course, inconvenient, but hey, an audience was an audience. At least I never got run in for bad material. Before that could happen, though, my New York manager at the time, Murray Becker, was able to find me a little house in which to live. The place was in Hollywood, near the foot of the hills, and belonged to Becker's boss, Jerry Purcell. I was told that the previous owner was Karen Black. As per Hollywood custom, houses don't become known as anyone's house until they move out. Anyway, I stayed there rent-free with another Purcell client, Chick Raines, a singer-songwriter who later found great success in Nashville. Chick and I, of course, were classic versions of the odd couple, the country-western musician and the hopeful comedian. Of the pair, I was obviously the Oscar Madison slob guy. We lasted together for about 6 months. Chick finally threw me out the day he saw me washing dishes with the same sponge I'd used to clean the toilet. That seemed perfectly normal to me. A sponge is a sponge, but he couldn't take it anymore. I said, "That's it! Get out!" Still another new strange California custom to comprehend. Before I got a car in L.A., I would hitchhike my way around town. Somebody had told me there were casting agents over in the Century City office tower. So I went out to Santa Monica Boulevard in West Hollywood, a neighborhood notorious in ways I was yet to understand, and tried to hitch a ride in that direction. My thumb was now 3 minutes when the car screeched up next to me. Very friendly guy opened his passenger door and said, "Hi, where you going? Want to go around the world?" "What?" I said, getting it. "Said you want to go around the world?" Seemed like an odd question. I said, no, I'm just trying to get to Century City." "How about a trip around the world?" And he's like winking at me. "So what are you talking about?" He goes, "Oh, you know." I'm thinking, this guy's nuts. I better get out of here. I said, "Oh, I forgot some. Thanks anyway." And I got out of the car. He pulled off and I started hitchhiking again. I gotten about a block away when another car stopped. Driver smiled and said, "Hi, how you doing?" I said, "Boy, the guys are friendly in this town." I got in and he repeated, "So how are you?" Then he gave me a couple of taps on the thigh. I said, "I'm fine." I said, "Good to see you. Where are you from?" He tapped my thigh again, this time a little more vigorously. I said, "To Boston." "Oh, Boston. Whew, I've been there. You know a club called The Hole?" "The Hole? No, I never heard of that. How about a place called The Ramrod?" "The Ramrod? No, I never heard of that one either. Where's that?" Back of Boylston, near the dock." He started touching my thigh again. I said, "Hey, cut that out. I forgot something at home. Let me get out of here." So I threw the door open fast, piled out, stuck my thumb out again. 4 minutes later, another car pulls up. People are very friendly in this town, or I was just attracting the weirdos. This guy started with the same line. "Hi, where you going? Where do you want to go?" I said, "Century City." "Any place special, man?" I said, no, I just heard there's some show business casting agents there." "Oh, trying to get into show business, huh? Film work?" I said, "Yeah, anything I can get." I realized he was looking me over way too closely. Then he said, "You know, I like guys like you." I wasn't sure what he meant, but said, well, thank you. Thank you very much. Then he pointed out the window and said, "Guys like that are way too obvious." We were driving past a man who was all but completely naked, wearing a little leather thong pouch and a feather in his hair. He said, "See what I mean? That's way too obvious." I said, "What's too obvious?" Then I realized, what an idiot I am. These people think I'm a male prostitute. No wonder they're picking me up. Get me out of here. I tell them, "Look, this is close enough. I'll get out of here." You know, I bought a car the very next day. I had no pretensions of becoming an actor, but other comics told me I'd probably make a good character in commercials or TV shows or movie or whatever. I think they meant this in the nicest possible way. I think. Anyway, if you were hired, the payday was great. Occasionally, I got lucky and did some stuff on sitcoms. Jimmy J.J. Walker got me a quick role on Good Times, in which I played a guy in a VD clinic. I wasn't quite sure I'd explain this to my mom, but hey, payday was great. Usually I was typecast as some kind of dumb and benign street guy thug, which I played on an episode of Laverne and Shirley, also on Alice as Mackenzie Phillips' biker boyfriend. I'm not sure how crazy I was about the typecast. You know, I remember once going on a casting call where I was greeted with, "What we're really looking for here is American-looking people." I said, "You know, I was born here. I was so installed. Looking around the room, I saw a half a dozen blonde surfer dude types. You know, I'd never really known what it was like to be discriminated against. I thought, oh boy, if people of color go through this every day, this must be very appalling." Another time I was told to go for an audition for a comedy part. At this point, I had a commercial agent who literally sent me out on everything, even if I was completely wrong for a role. His theory was, if you just showed up, maybe you could talk your way into anything. So I went to this casting office and sat down in the waiting room area. That's when I noticed every other guy there was short, very thin, pale, and wore horn-rimmed glasses. I thought, well, this is kind of odd. For hours, I waited. These little guys were called in one by one for their session with the casting director. Finally, it was my turn. As I walked into the room, director threw his hands up in disgust. "That's it! Okay! That's it! Stop! What do you think you're trying to pull here?" I said, "What are you talking about? Who in the hell told you you look like Woody Allen? Why are you wasting my time?" I said, "Me? Nobody told me I look like Woody Allen. This is a Woody Allen look-alike casting call. I am so sick of you deluded people coming in here, you psychos who think you look like Woody Allen. Do you really think you look like him?" I said, "No, I don't look anything like Woody Allen. Nobody, get out, just get out." You know, I just got out of there, completely embarrassed. But I found this aspect of the business even more humbling than risking death on stage doing stand-up. At least there, I was in control of my own fate. Even my own agency demonstrated new ways to humiliate me. Not long after, an ICM agent signed me. He was transferred to a different department, and I was handed to an underling. As these things worked, even if I became successful, all of the credit would still go to the guy who signed me. So the new guy had no reason to be interested in my career. But I sent him a copy of my resume and a standard 8x10 glossy headshot, and then went in to meet with the guy. Half-heartedly, he told me, "Well, there's not much going on now, but we'll keep you in mind." Naively, I said, "Really? You think you can find something?" "Oh, yeah. Yeah, we have great faith in you. Oh, we like your work." You know, and as I started talking to him, my eyes wandered around his desk and towards the trash can right next to it. From the top of the can, I saw a torn picture of someone, and what little I could see the hair in the picture looked familiar. Out of curiosity, I leaned forward to get a better view, and then I saw my nose and my eyes. It was my 8x10 torn in half and thrown in the trash can. Naturally, I wasn't nervy enough to call the guy on it, but I prodded him a bit. I said, "So you think you can find somebody?" "Oh, yeah. Yeah, we got your picture and resume on file." "Really? You have it on file?" "Oh, yeah. You sent it over the other day, right?" "Yeah." "Yeah, we have it. We have it." I stood up to leave and peered down into the circular file at my dismembered head. Boy, this is unbelievable. My own agent. I've been reduced to this. The face in the trash can. You know, I always thought your agent was supposed to lie for you, not to you. But I was pleased that they had such great faith in me. My face had suddenly become a controversial subject. For 20 years, it had caused me no real problems, but in Hollywood, that seemed to change. The classic moment of reckoning came as I sat with my agents at a network casting meeting. For some reason, in these sessions, people don't talk to you, they talk about you, like you're dead. It's as if I wasn't even there. This casting guy said, "We really like Jay, but we feel his face could be frightening to children. You know, I never heard this before, so I had to defend myself. I said, you know, I got nieces and nephews. I play with kids all the time. They're not frightened by me. The guy gave me that condescending, well, they're your family. Yeah, I guess you're right. I'm sure even the Elephant Man probably had people that cared for him, don't you think? Another time I went to a casting call where a guy started off by saying, look, I got to be honest with you. You know, whenever they want to be honest with you, you know something stupid was about to happen, which at this moment was true. After a dramatic sigh, he said, look, son, you should get your jaw fixed. He wrote down a name and handed me a scrap of paper. He said, go see this guy. He's done wonders for some of the biggest stars. And he mentioned one famous name and said, you know, he didn't always look like that. Really? Okay. So, obviously, I knew I had the strong Leno chin, but I was used to that. But now I was getting a little insecure. So I went to the Beverly Hills doctor, grabbed my face, and turned it this way and that way. And as he did this, he was making those little noises, like, jeez. Finally, he said, well, I see the problem. Problem? I said, what problem? You know, I have a girlfriend. She likes the way I look. I've always done well in life. Oh, but television. Ooh, that's another world. We can fix this and make you much more handsome. I said, well, all right, that sounds good to me. What do you have to do? He took a piece of chalk and began to draw on my face. Then he said, first we need to break the jaw here, here, and here, then rehang it. We use this steel thread that's a tenth of a millimeter in width. I said, break it and rehang it. Steel thread, ow, ow, ow. I said, how long will this take? He said, oh, no more than a week. I said, well, how long will it be before I can perform again? You know, he looked at me like I was a moron. He said, well, you won't be able to speak for about a year. A year? I can't not talk for a year. Oh, but after that, you'll have a great new look, and you'll work forever. But I can't take a year off. I'll forget my act. Well, it's your call. You've got to think long term. It's your life. It's up to you. You know, I'm still thinking. My frightening countenance eventually made its way onto the big screen, horrifying children throughout the nation. Mine would be a negligible film career, but embarrassing evidence exists nonetheless. If you don't blink, I can be spotted in the George Segal Jane Fonda movie Fun with Dick and Jane. In this, my first movie role, I'm the guy distressing a hardwood floor with a chain. Then in Americathon, I play the guy who fights his mother in a ring, boxing gloves and all, for money. And yes, I decked her. A very funny script, terrible movie. In American Hot Wax, the story of legendary rock and roll DJ Alan Freed, I was his chauffeur, a likable lug with the hots for Fran Drescher, who played the secretary. The director let us improvise a lot, which helped explain my screen time with Fran. In one stupid scene, I grabbed her boobs under the lame pretense of admiring her garments and said, this is wool, this is silk, and these must be felt. And then she slugs me. We also had a big kissing scene. She later wrote in her book that I was the best professional kisser she ever had, which was a nice thing to say. Unfortunately, professional kissing was never really a career option. I also had a pretty good part in the international heist movie, The Silver Bears. I played Martin Balsam's son, an extremely stupid thug whose father wanted him to learn the banking business. You know, how I got that role still amazes me. One day I was sitting in front of the Comedy Store when a guy walked up to me and said, you have a good face for a movie. Would you like to be in a movie? I'm thinking, oh, great, another one of these guys. What, do I look like the male prostitute of Los Angeles? At least he didn't ask me to go around the world. I rolled my eyes and said, yeah, sure, pal, I'll be in a movie. Why not? He said, good. We start in Switzerland in 2 weeks. Oh, great. Now he really does want me to go around the world. I said, look, pal, I'll go to Switzerland. I'll be in your movie. Why not? He said, great. Give me your phone number. I said, oh, this is unbelievable. I said, look, why don't you give me your phone number, okay? Okay. I give you my number. Which he did. And then, of course, I threw it away. A few days later, he comes back to the Comedy Store and he corners me. You did not call me. Oh, I must have lost your phone number. Well, you have to call producers. And he gave me the number of production office. Suddenly I realized, you know, maybe this guy's on the level. So I called the number and found this guy was actually the director of the movie, Ivan Passer. Like an idiot, I've been blowing off a real director. He'd seen my act and thought I was right for this movie. Luckily, he still wanted me. So, hey, week later, I'm on a plane to Switzerland, co-starring in The Silver Bears with Michael Caine, Sybil Shepherd, Louis Jourdan, Martin Balsam, and Tommy Smothers. Michael Caine and I hit it off right from the start. Great guy. I think we came from similar backgrounds. But more than anything else, we enjoyed playing tricks on Louis Jourdan, the great, classy French actor. We were filming at a beautiful mansion overlooking Lake Como that was owned by this astonishingly rich man. He even had an actual Gutenberg Bible in the living room. Also in the living room was his pet parakeet, which endlessly fascinated Louis. Every day, Mike and I would watch him go over to the birdcage and go, Allô? Allô, little parakeet? Allô? And the bird would just sit there, completely bored to death. One day, Michael said to me, look, let's have some fun with Louie. So we went into town and we bought the tiniest micro cassette recorder imaginable. Then in my best bird voice, I laid down an ongoing parakeet monologue on the tape. Over and over, I said, Brock, Louie's an asshole, Brock, Louie's an asshole, Brock, you moron, Brock, Louie, you pinhead, Brock. Anyway, we hid the recorder in the cage and waited for Louie to come into the room. That day, same as ever, he walked over to the cage and started going, hello, hello, little parakeet, hello. And as usual, the bird said nothing. Then Louie started to walk away. When his back was turned, I reached in and switched on the machine. Suddenly he heard, Brock, Louie's an asshole, Brock. He spun around shocked. Then he went back to the cage. Little bird, how can you say such a thing? Please stop, Brock. Louie's an asshole, Brock. Louie, what is wrong with this bird? Stop saying that things. Stop saying those nasty things. Why is this bird saying this? Of course, Michael and I were just dying. But hey, you know, you gotta kill sometime when you're in a foreign country. And to me, idiotic jokes are part of our international language. One of my first real television gigs after I got to Hollywood was on the Midnight Special, which aired Friday nights after The Tonight Show. Wolfman Jack was the host, and most of the acts were rock bands, but they also used the occasional comic. The show was taped in a fairly seedy area of Gower Street, and probably because of that, they couldn't get decent audiences. So, they would promise indigents and homeless people a box lunch and an apple if they would come in and be the audience. Plus, to give the show a more intimate feel, there were no seats, which meant all these people would sit on the floor and sort of mingle with the acts as they made their way to the stage. So after Wolfman Jack introduced me, I walked up and began my set. And not 2 feet away from me, on the floor, was this disheveled-looking guy eating his apple. As usual, I started out with a greeting. I said, hey, how you doing? And since the man was right next to me, I reached out to shake his hand, whereupon he just recoiled and went, I said, what? He was shielding his apple from me. I thought, hey, I'm not going to take your apple. Then he crawled back into the crowd and started eating the apple very quickly, so I couldn't get it away from him. I thought, oh, boy, big-time TV doesn't get any classier than this. Try and get a few laughs, and the guy thinks all I want to do is take his apple. There are technical nuances in television that took some getting used to. For example, at one point, I found myself booked on Dinah Shore's syndicated daytime talk show. That day, I went in to meet with a talent coordinator who said, okay, what's your last joke so the band knows when to play you off? In show business parlance, this is called an out cue, which mainly serves to cover up any dead air. So, as the comedian ends, the band always jumps in with ba-na-ba-na-ba-na-na-na-na-na-na-na, you know. Now, comedians hate this because it steps on the laugh and drowns it out. So I said to the talent coordinator, listen, do I have to give my last line? Well, how's the band leader going to know when you're done? I said, look, I like to hear the laugh and milk a little bit, so how about if I just say, thank you! Thank you very much. I'll say that twice. That'll be the cue. Got it? He goes, fine. So, during the show, I waited backstage for my introduction with Dinah Shore. Finally, I heard her say,
now we're going to hear from a very, very funny young man from Boston. He's got a unique brand of comedy. Please welcome Mr. Jay Leno. Come on out here, Jay.
Because Dinah had such a warm presence, she tended to infect audiences with her own enthusiasm. And this audience took her lead and responded a long, wonderful round of applause. Yeah, they're just going nuts. It was almost unnatural. Woo, yeah, yeah, applause, applause, applause. So I walked out and I started with my opening line. I said, hi, I'm from the United States. Any United States people here tonight? This got a huge ovation, much more than such a lame joke deserves. So I said, well, thank you. Thank you very much. At which point, the band leader looked over in panic, threw down his magazine, put out a cigarette, started playing, bana, 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 bana. I stood there, stunned. Bana, bana, bana. Meanwhile, Dinah, who had been reading her notes during all this, looked up, smiled broadly, and started applauding, which started the audience applauding even more. Now she's waving me over. Jake, come on over here. Come on over here, Jake. So I said, sure. So I shrugged and walked over to the couch. Still beaming, she said, sit right down. That's some of the freshest material I've heard in a long time. Is anybody paying attention here? Didn't she know I didn't even do my act? So I sat down and said, well, thank you very much. You know, at this rate, I could do this show 80, 90 times a year. And of course, nobody knew what I was talking about. This was the most ridiculous shot of my career. Of course, there's only one show that every comedian wanted to do, The Tonight Show. That was the holy grail, and it kept eluding me. I watched most of my peer group get their first shots on the show. Some of them just exploded onto the national scene, others faded away. But at least they had gotten their chance. I waited and waited for mine. Every few weeks, the show's talent coordinators would drop into the comedy clubs to check us all out. These visits were considered auditions. You knew they were there, and they knew you knew. On those nights, I would have my act down pat, but it didn't seem to matter. Very politely, I've been told I wasn't quite ready for the show yet. And I understood their reasoning. There are basically two kinds of comedians. You have the strong attitude comics with no real jokes, and you have the joke comics with no performing skills or attitude. The ones that usually make it tend to be both. At the time, I was pretty good at being loud and sarcastic and saying things like, "Yeah, that's great, if you're a duck!" Pure attitude. Amazingly, this sort of wiseacre stuff got big laughs, but you couldn't technically call them jokes, and that got to be a problem. Harvey Korman, then Carol Burnett's right-hand comic foil, enjoyed coming to the clubs and watching the young stand-ups. One night he brought Johnny Carson into the L.A. Improv specifically to see me and a few other comedians he liked. Of course, this sent an electric current right through the place. Johnny was in the house! Johnny's here! The mountain had come to us! It was thrilling and also a bit intimidating. But we all went up and did our acts, trying not to be self-conscious or at least not look like idiots. On my way out, I approached the table and said to Johnny, "Well, thank you for coming, sir." And he said very genuinely, "That was very funny stuff, but you're not quite ready yet. Your jokes are too far apart, and you don't have enough of them. You're getting good laughs, but you need more jokes." Well, I wasn't going to hear it from any greater authority. I used to tell interviewers that I thanked Johnny for the advice and then went outside and egged his car. But of course, I went outside and began thinking up jokes. For the next few months, I changed my act around and filled it with more jokes that had real payoff. Then one night, Steve Martin wandered into the Comedy Store and saw me. He was reaching his legendary peak as a stand-up, filling 15,000-seat arenas, wearing his white suit, changing comedy forever. He was already guest-hosting for Johnny, which was a pinnacle all its own. To us, he was kind of a superhero. Whenever he came into the club to try out new stuff, comics packed the room to watch, but he would sometimes just hang around to see the rest of us. And on this night, he caught me and said, "Hey, that was funny. I'm going to talk to the Tonight Show about you." Which he must have done, because the talent coordinators came right over and gave me another look. And next thing I knew, I was booked on the program. Johnny himself would be hosting. The date was set for March 2nd, 1977, which, of course, I couldn't forget even if I wanted to. This was going to be the moment of truth. Still, you didn't want to make yourself crazy worrying about it. But I was excited enough about it to go out and buy a video recorder so I could take my shot. Technology being what it was in 1977, I paid $1,200 for a basic machine, an enormous JVC tape recorder, completely incompatible with anything now. It seemed to be steam-driven and made of cast iron. It weighed like 350 pounds, and as best I could tell, was bulletproof. And the most you could tape was a half hour at a time. The tapes were huge, the size of a human head. You'd load them in, you'd hear, "Chunk, chunk." Then you'd press play, and lights would dim in the house. The belts on it would propel a Harley, a huge thing. But at least I was now ready to record myself for posterity. I remember I called home to tell my parents and mentioned that Johnny's other guests that night would be Burt Reynolds and Diana Ross. My mother weighed in with her inimitable show business perspective. "You know," she said, "I don't know why they always have on those big stars. Nobody wants to see the big stars. They all want to see the new people." I said, "Ma, I don't think anybody really wants to see new people." "No, no. I talk to my friends. They don't care about the big stars. They want to see the new people." Anyway, on the big day, a handful of my comedian friends went to NBC's Burbank Studios to provide moral support. Now, contrary to popular opinion, whenever a comic does a Tonight Show, his contemporaries really do wish him well, and some even show up to cheer and applaud. Among the ones who came for me was Robin Williams. We'd gotten friendly at the clubs, where everyone was amazed by his energy, but he hadn't gotten his break yet either. At one point that afternoon, I asked the Tonight Show talent coordinators, "How about this guy, Robin Williams?" They said, "Oh, we've seen him. He's all over the place. He runs around. He never sits still. He doesn't really have any jokes. He just does odd things. We don't think he's right for the program." Of course, within a year, he would be Mork from Ork, and children would be playing with dolls of his likeness. And an interesting footnote to my appearance on the show that night. If you ever see a tape or you ever watch one of Johnny's retrospectives and they show the shot, you can hear Robin's distinctive laugh in the background. Anyway, I went to my dressing room and saw the little Tonight Show card on the door with my name printed on it, which I naturally stole afterward. For wardrobe, I chose the best suit I had, which happened to be bright green. Now, surprisingly at the time, this was considered somewhat an attractive suit. It had been purchased for me to wear in the movie Silver Bears, which I did wear. Thinking in that movie I was playing a gangster kid with bad taste, but what did I know? Hey, suit's a suit. Years later, the only thing people remembered about my first appearance was that stupid suit. On his anniversary shows, Johnny would play the clip, which I call my blackmail tape, and Orr's remark about my sartorial style. Actually, I was secretly thrilled to be comic fodder for him. Once he described the suit as a used clown outfit. Another time he said it looked like an Italian elf. Anyway, I suppose that I was feeling as green as the suit looked, because before the show, Johnny's executive producer, Fred Dakota, took me aside to explain the rope. He said, "Look, after you finish your set, whatever you do, don't move. Stay on your mark and look at me. If I move my hands this way, I'm waving you to the couch. If I push away, that means just take a bow and go behind the curtain. But whatever you do, wait for my signal. Yes, sir, Mr. De Cordova. Yes, I got it. Fine, fine. And so, late in the program, after Burt Reynolds and Diana Ross had come out, I stepped through the curtain and did my first shot. I remember telling this joke. Have you seen any of David Janssen's commercials for Excedrin? That makes sense, doesn't it? The man looks like a headache. Well, I got a big laugh from Johnny, probably because he knew him, and it seemed to be going well. Then a minute and a half into my set, I was heckled by somebody in the audience. A guy actually shouted something at me. And out of the corner of my eye, I saw the staff panicking, and after a split second, I froze. All my years of telling jokes, hecklers were a staple. Who gets heckled on the Tonight Show? That never happens. It was like being heckled in church. So I just reverted to an old line I used in the clubs. I turned to Johnny and said, you know, Johnny, this same kind of guy who talks to TV at home. Look out, Kojak! Behind you! As if Kojak would tell him, why, thank you, viewer! You saved my life. Anyway, this got a huge reaction and really broke the ice. And more importantly, Johnny seemed to like it. Which was one of those dream comedic rites of passage. Johnny's laugh of approval, the only music that really mattered. Anyway, I finished my set, the band played my out cue. I said, thank you, and doing exactly as I was told, I look over at Fred DeCorda to find out where to go. And I saw him talking on the phone. People applauding. I kept staring at Fred, who now lit a cigarette and turned to speak to somebody else. What now? I felt like I was dying. The applause was fading. Telepathically, I'm screaming to Fred, help me! Help me! Now, all of this happened over the course of maybe 3 seconds, but to me, it might as well have been an hour and a half. Finally, Fred gave me a half wave towards the desk, so I walked over and shook Johnny's hand. He gave me a big grin, also got the wink, which is the greatest thing that could happen. Oddly enough, I was more nervous watching it at home later that night. Somehow, that made the experience feel both more real and more nerve-wracking. Or maybe it had more to do with worrying about whether my monster tape recorder would brown out the entire neighborhood. Over the next several months, I did the Tonight Show 2 or 3 more times. A couple of times, I got to sit on the couch next to Johnny, who was always very nice to me. During commercial breaks, he sometimes mentioned a joke that I told him, saying, hey, why don't you try the bit this way? Here's a line you could use. And he was always right. I soon realized I'd made the classic mistake among comedians. My first shot had been a compilation of my best material, and it had gone extremely well. The second shot was okay, not as funny, because I used the best of what I had left over. And the third shot, all in all, wasn't very good. See, the real trick is to get hot and then keep coming up with new stuff. If you continue to take from the well, eventually the well runs dry, as mine seemed to do. My appearances just trailed off, and I knew the inevitable. Back then, even now, if you don't make that big smash with your first few shots, you got to consider your options and try someplace else. For me, the best place seemed to be the road. If I couldn't get the nation's attention on television, I figured maybe I can do it one town at a time. And that would be my new game plan. I played Las Vegas, for example. In the past, I'd opened at Lake Tahoe several times for John Denver and Johnny Mathis, but for my Vegas debut, I'd opened for Tom Jones at Caesar's Palace. See, in those days, Caesars never gave opening acts any billing, especially with big stars like Tom Jones. So my name wasn't on the marquee outside or anywhere else in the showroom, which was okay. I was just happy to be working. My friend, Bud Friedman, who runs the improv, happened to be in town at the time and brought his wife and some friends over to visit me at the hotel. Then he asked me, hey, any chance you can get us tickets for your opening show tonight? Oh, no problem, I said, being a big shot, I'll get you in. There are always house seats available for performers anyway. So I led Bud and his wife and friends through the Caesars lobby to the ticket office. Feeling kind of important, I said to the woman behind the window, hi, I'd like some tickets for tonight's show. I'm sorry, sir, the show's sold out. Apparently the woman didn't recognize me. I said, oh, I know it's sold out. I'm Jay Leno, the opening act. She frowned at me and said, Mr. Jones does not have an opening act, sir. Oh. Well, yes, he does. I'm working with him. I don't think so. And of course, now I look like a complete idiot, a Bud just reveling in this, stifling his laughter, friends looking confused. I said, I am honest. Look, just find somebody. So she turned to the woman next window and said, Susan, is there an opening act for Tom Jones? I don't think so. Are you sure? Let me find out. The first woman said, can you wait here? At this point, tears are running down Bud's face. He can't stop laughing. Finally, the other woman returned and said, I guess there's some comedian, Jackie Leon. No, that's me. I'm Jackie Leon. Can I have some tickets, please? Anyway, the show went pretty good that night, and I felt pretty good about it. And just before Tom Jones ended his set, I walked through the showroom and out the main doors where the audience would shortly stream out. I figured this is my first time in Vegas. It'll be exciting to have people recognize you from the stage and, you know, kind of hand me a few accolades. As I stepped in the lobby, an attractive girl flashed a big smile and said, hey, great show, huh? I said, oh, well, thank you. He said, how are you doing? I said, good, good. He says, what are you doing now? I said, oh, I'm going to get a bite at the coffee shop. He said, really? Need any company? Right away, I'm thinking, this is great. Vegas. I've done my first show, and now a beautiful woman wants to be my entourage. I felt like Sinatra. So he sat down in the restaurant, started talking to me, and I said, where are you from? And she rolled her eyes and said, look, this chit-chat is all very nice, okay, but when are we going to get down to business? I said, business? What business? Plus $200. I said, what's $200? And she rolled her eyes again. Don't jerk me around. You pick me up. You know what this is all about. I said, I don't know what you're talking about, honest. Then she started yelling. Oh, you asshole. You guys are all assholes. Now people look over and whispering. Fine, asshole. Thanks for wasting my time. As she stomped out and passed the other tables, I distinctly heard people muttering, hooker, hooker. And then I realized, oh, she hadn't seen me on stage at all. She had no idea who I was. She would have said great show to anybody who came out of those doors. Oh, great. Now I'm a sleazeball comic picking up hookers. The worst part was overhearing a woman at the next table who looked just like my mom saying, and he seemed like such a nice young man. My life in comedy mystified my mother. For the longest time, she never quite understood what I did. She was especially puzzled by my constant road schedule. Up until The Tonight Show became a full-time job, I spent more than two-thirds of every year playing one-nighters in every state of the Union. In the middle of one long tour, I stopped home to see my folks. I happened to overhear my mom on the telephone trying to explain to someone what it is I did for a living. She said, well, he has these little skits that he puts on from town to town. Little skits? Suddenly I'm a vagabond village idiot traveling to different corners of the country where I'd sit in a dunk tank and people throw apples at me. Of course, there were times as I crossed the map where she wasn't far from wrong. For instance, there was a country western club near Atlanta called the Rodeo Lounge that wanted to take a chance with comedy. I actually worked there in a cage. By cage, I meant the stage was an enclosed chicken wire box which you entered through a chicken wire door. I went inside, latched the door behind me, started doing my act. This is the cue for drunken people to hurl glasses and beer bottles at the cage with all their might. The chicken wire would bend inward with every impact. I'd sort of dodge the incoming, trying to avoid being drenched in beer. I'd keep doing my act while guys screamed, hey, asshole, sing a song! Hey, sing! Start singing! I realized they had no idea what I was trying to do. More bottles hit. Then they would fill their mouths with whatever swill they were drinking and then spit these putrid gushers at me through the wire. This is the only place I ever worked where I had to towel off between jokes. I once had a pickup date at a New Mexico bar that had an interesting division of clientele. On one side of the room, there sat several guys dressed in real cowboy attire, hats and all. On the other side, Native Americans. Like some old Western saloon scene, they were split right down the middle, assembled to witness this so-called comedy night. I started my show and got a few laughs and went along. Both sides of the room seemed to be with me, at least a little bit. Then after one joke, a cowboy pointed across the room and hollered, that Injun over there, he's too stupid to get that one. Then a native Indian wearing a big stovepipe hat shot the cowboy a dirty look and hollered, hey, you shut up. What's the matter, Redskin? Bet you didn't get that joke either. Now the Native American started yelling at the cowboy. Another cowboy started yelling at the Indian. Suddenly, my act had touched off a range war. Barbs are flying back and forth, which, of course, was preferable to bullets and flaming arrows, I guess. At least the West had evolved enough to let childish insults do the job, and they just kept sparring. Why don't you shut your mouth?
Yeah, why don't you shut your mouth, white man?
I said, look, fellas, take it easy. We can all work together. Suddenly, I feel like Dr. Quinn, medicine woman, on some bad babysitting job. Just cut it out. Will you guys behave yourselves? After the show, the manager came over and said, listen, I don't think this comedy thing is going to work out. One of my earliest road gigs ever was at a strip joint in Minnesota called the Mine Shaft. I was still living in Boston and quite obviously taking any job I could find. The Mine Shaft was remarkable in only one way. The place had no lights, none at all. The room was pitch dark. Customers paid $5 to get in, and for another $5, they would each get a genuine coal miner's hat complete with a light on top. The light would then fall on whatever the audience was looking at. So whenever dancing girls came out, all the coal miners' lights would fix on whatever part of the woman they wanted to look at. I walked out and started doing my act. Hi, everybody. How you doing? I immediately realized I couldn't even see the microphone in front of my face. I stood there telling jokes in total darkness. The reason, of course, were naked women were dancing in all four corners. Nobody wanted to look at a comic on stage when there was that option available. Finally, the occasional person would glance at me, probably see what was distracting them. And then the light would hit me in the eye, and I'd have to stare at the ground. And each time this happened, I was instantly blinded by the flash of light. I'd go into these horrible fits of squinting and blinking. I couldn't even see the audience. I felt like I was being strobed by lasers. All in all, standing in the darkness was actually better. The road is unforgiving. It is also endless. By the mid-70s, comedy clubs were popping up in most cities trying to cash in on the boom started by the improv and the comedy store. Most of these gigs were fairly horrible. Audiences hadn't gotten the hang of actually paying attention to comedians yet. Often I would come on stage to virtually no applause, much less to any remote sort of feigned interest. Usually I begin by saying, "What a wonderful ovation. Well, you people are just too kind. I can't handle it. Good night." Then I'd turn to leave, which usually got a dopey laugh, followed by some fleeting attention, followed by more disinterest. At some indiscernible point, clubs started adopting truly stupid names that sounded more like host of snack cakes and night spots. There are places called ho-hos, ha-has, hee-hees, tickles, giggles, jokers, zanies, and my personal favorite, the Comedy Inn. Sillier were the theme clubs like the Comedy Boat, an actual floating barge where if the act didn't make you sick, the tossing of the tide usually would. The dumbest of all, whose name now escapes me, was located on a tiny island about 100 yards offshore on a Canadian lake. To get there, a kid would row four people out at a time in a small skiff. Now, this wasn't so bad before shows, but once the place closed for the night, bedlam broke loose on the island. About 100 people bolted outdoors like the club was on fire, knocking each other over, trying to get in the rowboat. The kid would have to paddle furiously, island to shore, four people at a time, for at least 3 hours. Every night he looked like he'd been gripping the new and more agonizing hernia. This was a terrible idea for a place. It soon closed because nobody wanted to wait 3 hours for their car. Then there was the Comedy Deli, located in the hills of West Virginia, big coal mining country. I opened there with an older black comedian who on different nights identified himself either as Red Fox's brother or Flip Wilson's cousin. Neither seemed to be true. He had that kind of self-discriminating act that black comics did in the 50s just to get work in front of white audiences. One of his lines, "I'm not really colored, it's just the lights here are very bright." And when the audience applauded that line, I knew I was in trouble. Anyway, this place was an actual deli that had been converted into a nightclub. But no changes had been made to the place other than the inclusion of a stage. There were no cocktail tables or chairs, just regular high-back deli booths, none of which even faced the stage. So you couldn't actually see anybody in the audience. And they could only see you by turning around and peeking over the top of the booth. I would look out at this creepy spectacle of disembodied eyes peering back at me from banquette. It was like playing in front of children of the damned. If there was any laughter, it was muffled by the thick upholstery. In fact, the only thing I heard clearly was the horrible hacking coughs of the coal miners, which would be like a Now imagine 20 to 30 people doing that at the same time. It was ear-shattering. I couldn't even finish jokes. It sounded like a bunch of heart attacks in progress. I kept thinking, should I call paramedics? And after about a week, the manager became the second guy to tell me, look, thanks, son, but I don't think this comedy thing is going to work here. On the road, I'd find myself doing things I'd never do at home. For example, no matter what small town I went through, I'd read the whole newspaper, section after section. More than once, I caught myself muttering, "Look at this, tuna casserole with a graham cracker crust. Huh, isn't that interesting? I wonder how you make that." Without question, the worst part of road life was killing time in daytime, waiting for nighttime to fall so you could get on with your show. My entire offstage existence seemed to revolve around watching television in whatever motel room I occupied. If I did have to leave the room to do something, I'd gauge my activities by the TV Guide listings, which I read with religious fervor. I always used to bring a copy of TV Guide with me on the Letterman show to amuse Dave with the most stupid entries I found. So it would be like lunch at 1 o'clock, Brady Bunch at 2, take a walk at 3, Three Stooges at 4, just a pathetic existence. But for my money, nothing matched the sheer entertainment value of People's Court, a program that spotlighted the most desperate displays of human pettiness ever broadcast. Next-door neighbors suing each other over possession of a garden hoe. I'll never forget the time a woman came to the show with her hair in curlers. All I could think of was, where is this woman going later? She's on national TV for the first time in her life. What's she having dinner with Gorbachev? She's got to come on TV now with her hair in curlers? But the People's Court saved my life on the road. Whenever it came on the air, I'd be so excited I'd get up and do this stupid dance, which Mavis came to christen the litigant. I now perform it on The Tonight Show. Dan da dan da dan da dan da dan da dan da. Just kind of goes like that. It's not really a dance, but then I don't dance anymore. My most memorable road TV watching incident, and isn't it sad that there is one, took place in Cherry Hill, New Jersey, when I was playing a place called the Latin Casino. This is the kind of club that tended to attract an intimidating clientele, to say the least. Even the management liked to create a sense of foreboding just to make sure he didn't ask for a raise. He would bring you into his office on the first day to show you his gun collection. Anyway, I was put up for the week in a really cheap motor court motel right off the highway where you could hear cars and trucks whizzing by at all hours. Rooms cost $6 a night, for which the accommodations included ashtrays screwed to the tabletops and televisions that had to be fed quarters in order to play. A quarter would get you 20 minutes of programming, which meant that you could never see a show in its entirety. Dramatic plots would always hang in the air, and the murderer is pink! And naturally, there were no change machines in the place. I'd go down to the front desk where they'd sneer and point to a sign that said, "No quarters!" But that was the least of it. The motel was all cinder block, and each room was divided by a thin piece of plasterboard, which didn't quite reach the ceiling or the floor. So there'd be an open space of about 2 inches at the top and the bottom of the wall, exposing you to whatever was going on in the next room. One night I was lying in bed watching a quarter's worth of TV when I heard a couple check into the room next door. I looked down the floor and saw the toes of a pair of men's shoes slide through the open crack into my room. Ugh, this is really sleazy. I tried not to think about it and kept watching TV. Suddenly I heard a man's voice, as though he was in bed next to me, say,
"Could you turn that down?"
I looked around mystified and then realized the headboard of the couple's bed next door met the thin wall my headboard was. The voice came on again, very calm and even toned.
"Could you turn that down, please?"
I said, "What?"
"Turn that TV down."
So I lowered the volume to a barely audible setting.
"Turn it down a little more, please."
"Yeah, okay. Okay, sorry." At this point, I was just looking at the pictures move now, whereupon the couple behind me started to have sex. You know, you could hear the spring squeaking, headboard going bang, bang, bang. Felt like I was in the room with them. Then the woman said, "I think that guy can hear us." "No, he can't." "Yes, he can." "No, he can't."
"Yes, I can," I said.
That seemed to kind of kill the mood. They checked out about 45 minutes later. Here's a story about the worst lodgings ever. A club owner in Bakerfield didn't want to spring for motel accommodations for comedians, so he put the comedians up in what he called his guest condo. This is not a condo at all, but actually a two-car garage next to his house. He kept the car in one bay, and in the other bay, he installed a bed. I'd be sleeping at midnight, and then suddenly the garage door would slowly screech open, and his wife would pull in her car right next to the bed. Under the covers, I'd look up and basically find myself on the street. I'm on the street as cars drove by. Then the wife would get out and go, "Sorry." Then she'd tiptoe out of the garage, and the door would shut again. Very surreal way to sleep. Here's the strangest way I ever got a room. There was a motel next to the Front Row Theater in Cleveland. This place was so close to the highway, when you opened your door, beep, beep, beep. Beep, 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 beep. You can actually feel the breeze as the cars rushed by you. Anyway, I went to check in, and the woman just said, "I'm sorry, we're all booked up." I explained there was a room for me because it was set up by the theater. She looked again and said, "I'm sorry, there's nothing." Then from the back, I heard a loud ruckus. A man was screaming, "Get out and stay out!" It was the manager, and he was evicting rock star Steven Stills. Down the hallway came Steven looking rumpled and kind of forlorn. He glanced at me and said, "Hey, Jay, how you doing?" I said, "Hey, Steven, how are you?" So they threw him out the door along with his bags, at which point the woman turned to me and said, "I think something just opened up." Now here's probably the oddest media request on the road. I was working in Reno with Tony Orlando and got a call from the local TV station. The anchor woman said she had an idea for a news feature and wanted me to be a part of it. I told her to come by, and when she did, I asked, "What's the story?" She said, "Oh, well, we're doing a story on celebrity loneliness. And since you're on the road so much, we thought you'd have a lot to say about it." Celebrity loneliness? Aren't there more pressing problems in the world to be taken care of? So I said to her, "Look, why don't you talk to Tony Orlando? You know, Dawn left. He's all alone. I think he might have a lot to tell you." Reno was always an odd place to work. The shops in town sold the most ridiculous gift merchandise. Not that I'm any kind of tastemaker, but you do have to wonder about any place that would sell sterling silver ashtrays in the shape of human buttocks with the inscription, "Park your butts here." I also remember seeing a $12,000 solid gold statue of a man holding a barrel around his torso, and when you pulled the barrel down, the man would pee on you. Just lovely, lovely conversation pieces. In this rather strange environment, I once went looking for a birthday present for my mother. I found a pawn shop, thinking, well, maybe I'll have some antiques for sale. I explained my situation to the guy at the counter. He said, how old a woman is she? I said, 72. 72. How about this? And then he pulled out a pearl-handled derringer. I said, you know, I don't really think she wants a gun. And then he said, oh, sir, it's a woman's gun. You see the inlaid pearl there? It's all handcrafted. Really beautiful. I think she'll love it. He was completely serious, so I figured I'll try to reason with him. I said, look, sir, you know, it's only a single shot. What if she misses? You know, she couldn't reload in time before somebody returned fire. This seemed to make sense to him. He said, yeah, good point. Well, how about a larger gun that holds 6 or 8 bullets? Oh, yeah, but then it won't fit in her purse. Of course. How about something in a repeating rifle? Look, I don't want a repeating rifle. Look, I'll look somewhere else. You know, it's really been a long time since she had a shootout with the paperboy or anybody else. One of my first out-of-town gigs was at the famous Chicago club, Mr. Kelly's. I opened for the singer Frida Payne, who had the big hit Band of Gold. When I hit town, the entertainment director came to see me at my hotel. He said, listen, before you come to the club tonight, I want to tell you, we've got a little problem with the marquee, okay? We ran out of E's. So what do you mean we're out of E's? He said, we only got 2 E's. Frida Payne used up both of them. So what are you saying? Well, on the sign out front, you're J.L. No. What do you mean, J.L. No? He said, nobody gonna notice. Don't worry about it. So that night, I was billed as J.L. No, and the show went on anyway. In fact, in the review in the Chicago paper the very next day, they were quite complimentary. It said, Mr. No is a bright young comedian who opened the show for Miss Payne. I was once hired to play the ballroom of an old hotel in Ogunquit, Maine. Very conscientiously, they called to ask if I needed anything special in order to perform. I said, no, no, I'm fine. They said, do you need an opening act? I said, no, no. You know, I do over an hour, so I don't think we'll need it. Anyway, I arrived at the hotel about a half hour before the show. As always, I asked, how's the sound system? The guy looked puzzled. He said, well, you're bringing that, aren't you? I said, I don't have a sound system. Hey, we asked you if you needed anything. I said, well, I assume you had a microphone. He goes, no, we don't have a microphone. This hotel was built in the 1800s. We don't have a sound system. But you got a nightclub. It's not a nightclub. It's a ballroom. We're just trying a comedy night. So I had to stand in the stage of this cavernous ballroom and shout, how you all doing? Anybody been at McDonald's? People yelling back, what? What did you say? I said, anybody been at McDonald's? So I tried a different tactic. I walked around among the crowd telling my jokes, which of course caused people to be furious because they said, hey, why are you always over there? Why don't you come over here? I said, you ever been to McDonald's? After the guy came over and said, listen, I don't think this comedy thing is going to work out. Here's another variation on that same desperate theme. Early on, I went down to George Washington University in D.C. to open for the group Rare Earth. Now, the stage was set up in a gymnasium. There were no chairs for the audience, which was comprised mostly of surly teenage boys. So they all stood around loitering like punks. Before the show, I approached the manager of the stage crew, and I said, hi, I'm the opening act. He said, yeah, how you doing? They couldn't have cared less. I said, listen, which mic do you want me to use? The guy said, hey, you can't use any of them. We got very expensive equipment here, buddy. I said, well, look, I got to use something. The guy said, I don't care. You're not using our stuff, and you can't use our stage either. Everything's set up for our guys. We don't want you screwing it up. I said, I can't get on the stage? No, we don't want you on the stage. Then the event promoter took me aside and said, look, they don't want you on stage, okay? They're the ones people came to see. You're going to have to work down on the floor. I said, but the audience is standing on the floor. I'll be standing right in the middle of them. That's fine. Just stand in the middle of them. Finally, somebody got me a microphone with an extra long cord to snake down through the gym floor. There wasn't even a box for me to stand on. So I walked out, bumped into all these teenagers, and I'm standing there eye to eye. I said, hi, everybody. How you doing? I'm the opening act. Anybody here from Boston? Suddenly, I sensed trouble coming. Next thing I knew, somebody grabbed the mic wire and jerked it hard. The mic flew out of my hand straight into the crowd. I screamed, hey, give me that. Hey, give me that mic! And now I'm pushing kids out of the way. Frantically, I duck down, and I start chasing the mic through their legs. Then I hear some kid's voice going over the speaker. Hey, Larry, hey, Billy, you suck, Mikey! Yeah, that's how Charlie! Woo! Finally, I find the wire, and I start pulling on it. I follow all the way to the end, where the mic has been ripped loose, and, of course, stolen. My act was finished before it even began. Not only was I not paid, I also got charged $75 for losing the mic. I was told by the promoter, you're a professional. You should be able to hang on to the equipment we give you. I once played the Cellar Door in Washington for a week, opening for Muddy Waters, the legendary blues guitarist, which was a huge thrill. Now, usually, blues and comedy are a pretty good mix. Usually. On the first night, I wasn't on stage more than a minute when, from the corner of my eye, I spotted a large, menacing guy off to the left. He looked to be angry and seemed to be sidling towards the stage. I didn't give much thought, and I began telling another joke when I felt the guy on stage right behind me. I turned just as he brought a Heinz ketchup bottle down on my head. Bonk! I went out. I heard the audience cheer, "Yeah, woo! That'll teach him!" I was out cold. When I woke up, the back of my head was shaved, and I had 8 stitches. Worse yet, I'd been docked a night's pay because, according to the owner, as a professional comedian, I should expect things like that to happen. Once again, I realized all good comedians should travel with a cut man. I remember one time I was doing a string of gigs in Oklahoma. And going through Oklahoma City, I asked somebody for a restaurant recommendation. He said, "Aren't you Italian?" E-Y-E. "We got one of the best Italian restaurants around here. In fact, the owner's from Iowa." Anyway, I went there, and I saw the red checkered tablecloths and the wine bottles on the wall, all of which looked promising. So I figured, hey, take a chance. I ordered spaghetti and meatballs, and the waiter asked, "You want fries with that?" "It comes with fries, you know." So I got the fries, plus 3 slices of Wonder Bread for sopping up the marinara sauce. As they say, when in Oklahoma City, do as the Romans do. By the way, this was vastly preferable to a place in West Virginia where the menu listed something called a WAP salad. The waiter explained that it was a regular salad, but made with Italian dressing. I said, "Oh, of course, how foolish of me not to know that." Then there was the old diner in Des Moines that hung a sign boasting, "Pizza, the newest taste treat, and you can eat it with your hands." And it showed kids doing something that looked like the twist and showing you how to eat pizza as well. Another great Oklahoma spectacle was the church row you found in most towns. All along these thoroughfares, church after church would have marquees announcing the sermon of the day. And in the tradition of old-time religion, every church would try to top the next one with a stunning biller. "Ex-biker talks about his life with the gang and his return ride to Christ." Then 100 yards down the road, there'd be another one. "Ex-prostitute tells how she finally wound up in bed with the Lord." This was like daytime television with preachers presiding instead of Ricky Lake and Geraldo. But I got an even better sense of regional piety in Tulsa. I was playing an old auditorium where the audience was very nice and very receptive. Not long after starting my act, I noticed that a man in the front row seemed to have something written in chalk on the sole of his shoe. I couldn't make out what it said, so I ignored it. Anyway, I went out with my act, and I saw another guy with something scrawled on his shoe, and I thought, well, what is that? Well, this is getting strange. So as I walked the stage, I made an effort to look at everyone's shoes, and I'd say that 4 out of 5 people had something written on the bottom of their shoes, all in white chalk, and I couldn't figure out what it was. Afterwards, I found the local promoter, and I said, what's going on? What that people have written on the bottom of their shoes? He said, oh, yes, that's Satan. I said, what do you mean, Satan? He said, well, we have a preacher here in town. He tells his parishioners to write Satan on the bottom of their feet with chalk. This way, when they walk around, they'll be stomping him out. Of course! That makes perfect sense! I've been staring at a sea of Satan stompers. Although I guess it was sort of flattering. I mean, hey, if you're going to see Satan anywhere in Oklahoma, it's probably going to be at my show. And then one time, the view from the stage changed my life. In January of 1976, I stood on stage at the Comedy Store and saw Mavis Nicholson. Dark, attractive, intelligent-looking. She even laughed in the right places. But this was something different. I knew I had to meet her. In those days, comedians had a surefire way of accomplishing that goal. You would hang around outside the woman's bathroom. If you waited there long enough, every woman would eventually pass through those portals. So I loitered there, and as true romance would have it, that's where we met. I believe I asked her out, and I believe she accepted, and after a short while, there wasn't a point where she wasn't part of my life, sharing all these stupid and great adventures and helping to make a little bit of sense of them. We were and are opposites in most every way, which I like. There's a better balance. At the time we met, Mavis did write comedy, but our worlds would diverge from there on. She was raised in L.A., the product of a quirky, kind of eccentric family. Her father, Nick Nicholson, was a fun-loving character whose face turned up in all kinds of TV shows and movies. He also played the hooded executioner in the film In Cold Blood. And as different upbringings tend to dictate, her qualities are the ones I lack. I don't consider myself to have much of a spiritual side, but Mavis almost always has a sixth sense about people and situations. She has a deep focus, and I fly off in 20 directions at once. She reads about 15 books a week, mostly classic literature. You know, I collect my goofy car and motorcycle books. She loves European travel. I don't want to go anywhere if people want to understand my jokes. She can throw out old stuff. I save everything. I have every car, every bike, everything I ever had. Mavis has no mechanical ability whatsoever and wouldn't begin to know how to use a screwdriver, but she can spell stuff. Most importantly, she exposes me to things and ideas that would never have come my way, and if they did, I wouldn't have noticed them unless she was there. This is why I think we're able to work as a genuine team. From the start, though, those realms could intersect nicely. For instance, the first place you ever made love was in the backseat of my 55 Buick Roadmaster. After moving to L.A., I answered a newspaper ad and bought the car for $350. I had no place else to stay, and I often slept in it. It was a very big car. It could seat 7 for dinner. I used to say it didn't have a radio. It was so big I'd bring in live acts. Anyway, I still have that car. It's parked in my yard. I would never sell it for obvious sentimental reasons. I always told my dad if I ever made it in show business, I'd buy him a Cadillac and a Lincoln. So as soon as I started guest hosting with Johnny, I went back to Andover and took him shopping for a Cadillac. The Lincoln would come later. Now, Cadillac salesmen are different from any other car salesmen, especially back east. They demonstrate affluence by wearing loud plaid jackets and smoking big cigars, which is to say their taste sometimes seems questionable. Now, on this day, the salesman led my father directly to a white 86 Cadillac with the red velour interior. My dad wanted it right away. The salesman said, "Now, Mr. Leno, your Cadillac could have the regular interior, or you can have what you're looking at now, the beautiful interior d'elegance." Of course, the interior d'elegance was just the worst of Detroit. Big, tufted, rolled upholstery. It looked like something that belonged in Elvis's coffin. Whenever you sat in it, you'd sink like 3 feet into the cushion, and after 20 minutes, your back would be killing you. But for that first 30 seconds, it was like a feather bed. My dad's eyes lit up. "Hey, I like that interior d'elegance." So that's what we got. Then we drove it home to show my mom, who hated the idea of a Cadillac to begin with. She deplored any ostentatiousness of any kind. She would say, "We're not Cadillac people. We're simple people. We're not Cadillac people." She came out to meet us in the driveway and just covered her eyes with shame, especially when she saw the interior d'elegance. To her, this just looked like a brothel on wheels. From that day forward, when my mom and dad rode around the Cadillac, she would slump down below the window level so people wouldn't see her. And then she'd always mutter, "We look like who's who driving in this thing. We're not Cadillac people." My father, on the other hand, would honk and everyone in town yell, "Hey, my boy bought this for me. We're not Cadillac people," my mother would shout back. Which, of course, was the basic difference between my parents. When he came to see my shows, his greatest thrill was to stand up and wave to the crowd, "Hey, that's my boy on the stage!" He enjoyed nothing more than giving out my home number to people he met on the street who were fans of mine. "Oh, call my boy up! He'd love to hear from you!" Whenever he saw somebody on TV tell a joke that he liked, he'd call me and say, "Use this! Here's a good joke for you!" And I'd say, "Dad, that's Jerry Seinfeld's joke." "Oh, go ahead! He won't mind!" You know, I think show business almost suited my dad better than it did me. One day he went outside to get the newspaper at the end of the driveway, and he found the guy there who'd been waiting hours to meet him. He said, "Hi, Mr. Leno. I'm a magician. I'd like to get in touch with your son." My father said, "A magician? Well, let's see your act." My dad sat there at the end of the driveway the next 45 minutes while this guy put on a magic act on the lawn. Then he gave the guy my home number. "Call up my boy. Oh, he'll put you on the Tonight Show. No problem." In 1986, I played Carnegie Hall, which my parents wouldn't have missed for the world, and they brought every relative in the tri-state area. Now, I'd only been to Carnegie Hall once before, when I crawled through a window one day in the early 70s and sneaked on stage to see what it was like. I just wondered what it was like to stand on stage at Carnegie Hall. Then somebody yelled, "Hey, you, what are you doing?" And I ran out of there. This time, I hoped to be on stage a little bit longer. Certainly, I wanted to do right by my folks. So to class things up a bit, I hired a little 3-piece string ensemble to play before I started my act. And this immediately impressed my mother. Usually she would come to my shows with a somewhat pained expression on her face, never quite understanding what was going on. But after hearing the music, she said, "Oh, I like this. This is much better than those jokes. Now people will enjoy this." Anyway, the ushers took them to their seats, 5th row center, along with Mavis and all the relatives, which I guess turned into some minor production of its own. Now, 3 19-year-old boys were sitting directly behind my parents, and they must have quickly figured out who they were. One of the kids leaned forward, tapped my dad on the shoulder, and asked, "Are you Jay's father?" My dad, for all his showbiz enthusiasm, never quite got used to the idea that I'd become well-known. And he never fully understood that I aged beyond my teenage years, so he turned around to the kid and said, "Hey, you know my boy? Have you been over the house? Are you a friend of Jay's?" He figured these must have been kids I work with at McDonald's. No, Miss Lana, we're just fans." "What? You haven't been to the house?" Anyway, I finally took the stage, and the crowd couldn't have been better. I started doing my material, some of which the kids behind my parents must have known from watching me on Letterman. They were laughing at the setups and the payoffs. Anyway, these guys just kept laughing and laughing, and my mother had no idea what to make of this, so at one point she turned around, pressed a finger to her lips, and went, "Shh! Shh! Quiet!" Now, I saw all this from the stage, and I just stopped the show. I said, "Ma! Ma, don't shush people! It's a comedy show! They're supposed to be laughing!" And, of course, this mortified her. To be singled out in public was the worst of all embarrassments, and at Carnegie Hall. But she knew this was one of my favorite things to do to her, and I did it whenever possible. Once she and my Aunt Faye came to Atlantic City to see me perform, but that night when I stepped on stage, their front row seats were empty. I said to the audience, "Where's my mother?" "Oh, here she comes, everybody!" Now, this was just horrifying to her. The two of them had been out in the casino playing slot machines. And now, feeling everyone's eyes upon them, they crept self-consciously towards their table, holding their plastic containers full of nickels. And just as they got down front, my mother nervously dropped all her nickels on the floor, about 50 bucks worth. Crash! Which just gave me another opportunity to tease her. "Ma, will you stop? I'm trying to work here." Another humiliation. In fact, I even took this exercise into the private sector. As a kid, and all the way into adulthood, this was my favorite thing to do to my mom. We would go to the supermarket together, and then I'd sneak off and have her paged on the intercom. I'd tell the store manager, "I'm trying to find my mother. She's an elderly woman, and she forgets where she is. I think she's lost. Could you say her name?" Of course, my mother would be looking at the produce, and you'd hear, "We're paging a Mrs. Leno. If you are lost, Mrs. Leno, please come to the manager's office." And, of course, like a sprint runner, she'd come tearing through the store, screaming, "Oh, stop doing that! Stop doing that!" Of course, my mom could dish it out as well as take it. For example, she elevated the art of backseat driving to new peaks of annoyance. She had the ability to never actually state her complaint out loud. Instead, she would sing them in a shrill little voice, then pretend you didn't hear it just to make you crazy. Now, it happens whenever she and my dad came to visit me in L.A. I drive them around and point out various sites. "Oh, look, Ma, there's Jimmy Stewart's house. We could enjoy it if he weren't speeding by." "What's that, Mom?"
"Nothing, nothing."
Then I drive for a while.
"There's a stop sign."
"Ma, I see the stop sign."
"I said nothing."
"Ma, will you stop it, please? I'll look over. Oh, look, Ma, there's where Tom Jones lived."
"We could enjoy it if we weren't going so fast."
"We're not going fast. We're only going 3 miles an hour." She also had a habit of giving automotive advice when she had no idea what she was talking about. One day I had her in the car when I got a flat tire, and I opened the trunk to get a jack, but it wasn't there. And I came back and I told her, "Ma, we got a flat. There's no jack. I can't change the tire. We're going to have to wait for the tow truck."
"Did you check the battery?"
I said, "Ma, it's got nothing to do with the battery. It's a flat tire. We can't change the tire without a jack."
"Your father always checks the battery first whenever there's a problem with the car."
I said, "All right, Ma, you want me to check the battery? I'll check the battery." So I opened the hood. I said, "Mom, look, I checked the battery. It's not the battery. The battery's fine."
"Well, now you know for sure."
"I knew before it wasn't the battery, Ma." One thing my mom would never tolerate was anyone who took the Lord's name in vain, me especially. This was a huge issue with her. She would say,
"People might steal money because they have to eat, or maybe they get into a fight to protect someone and they go to prison, but there's no reason to ever take the Lord's name in vain."
I remember being home in the mid-80s watching the Roberto Duran-Sugar Ray Leonard fight on TV with my dad. My dad always liked to have someone watch the fights with him. Anyway, we really got caught up in the action. Great fight, punches flying back and forth. Then one of the fighters took a fall, and I hollered, "Oh, Christ, he barely got hit." Then I heard what I thought was hoofbeats. I said, "What's that, an earthquake? Why is the house shaking?" Suddenly, bonk, my mother hit me in the head with a pot. "Ow, not in this house. I was out cold." "You'll not say, ow, there was a dent in the side of my head." Then my father looked over and said, "Oh, yeah, that's right, son. Don't say that in front of your mother." There was never a moment when my parents actually tried to discourage me from going to the show business. Early on, my Aunt Nettie would tell my mom,
"He's wasting his time. He's not going to make it in show business. Look at Bobby Peterson. He's got a good job at the factory."
And truth be told, my mom probably would have liked me getting a steadier line of work, especially my first couple of years in Los Angeles, which seemed to her as if I'd gone off seeking my fortune as a panhandler in some foreign country. You know, at time, I would often exaggerate the accomplishments of other people in show business, hoping that she would better understand what possibilities lay in store for me. I remember one time I called her and I told her that Sylvester Stallone had just signed an enormous deal to make the movie Fist. So I called home and I said, "You know, Ma, Sylvester Stallone just got $12 million for 10 weeks' work." And then there was this long pause. She said, yes, but what happens the other 42 weeks? What's he going to do if nothing else comes in? Then he's going to be stuck, isn't he? See, to my mom, it was always better to have $150 coming in every week than just to get, you know, $12 million in cash up front. And even when I started making better than decent dough, she never quite comprehended it. Worse yet was the idea that I could spend it on her. This was inconceivable, a complete waste of money in her eyes. Plus, you'd never, ever ask for anything. I remember during one of my trips home, I was sitting with her at the kitchen table one night, and she seemed out of sorts, and I said, what's up, Ma? She said, oh, well, you know, your father and I were at the mall today, and I saw this blouse I like, but it cost $90, and that's just too much money. I said, Ma, you want the blouse? Look, here's $100. Go buy the... Don't put that on. Your father will get upset if I take money. Just take... If your father finds out I took money from you, he's not going to find... Look, take the $100. Just don't tell Dad. And of course, a small covert action like this represented just the height of dishonesty to my mother.
Well, I don't know. Did you think... Ma, just take the $100. Now, oh, all right.
The next morning, I'm sitting at breakfast with my dad. I said, what the hell's wrong with your mother? She's up all night. She's pacing the floor. She didn't get any sleep. I said, oh, I said, I don't know, Pop. I mean, Mom came into the kitchen looking nervous, huge bags under her eyes. She started to pour my father's coffee. He said, what are you going to do, honey? Going to go to the mall today? Coffee flying everywhere. You think she'd been caught pulling the Brinks job. I said, look, Dad, I'm buying Mom a blouse, okay? Can we leave it at that? In my ongoing effort to try and drag my parents into the 20th century, I once got them a VCR. I explained to them they could now just tape Matlock and then watch it whenever they wanted. Well, this sounded like a dream come true. Plus, they could rent movies or look at tapes of my late-night appearances without having to stay up. Of course, the problem, trying to explain to them how it worked. You know, it came to technology. My mom didn't even want to learn. She started talking about the automatic timer, and her eyes would just glaze over. And when my father couldn't get it to work, he pulled out the pliers. Let me open the back and take a look. Dad, don't open the back. Maybe the screw is... There's no screws in it, Dad. It's electronic. You just set the timer. Don't open the back. I remember once I tried to show my mom how to work the timer. I said, look, Ma, here's what you do. Now, what day do you want to watch it?
I want to watch it today.
Well, it doesn't say today on the machine, Ma. You got to press Wednesday.
Well, how does it know it's Wednesday?
It's got a brain. It just knows. When I told my mom you could tape one show while watching another show, you would have thought I said, men from Mars have landed. It's the end of the world. Man can go no further in his technological attempts. None of this mattered, of course, because the next several months, my phone bill showed hundreds and hundreds of dollars spent calling him to try to explain how to use this stupid thing. Look, Ma, tell Daddy to put the tape in and press play. You have to press play. Your father says it'll cause a fire. It's not going to cause a fire. Just press play. He's afraid to touch it. He lived through the Depression, all right? Just press play. And, of course, this whole nightmare started because I told a lie. When I told him I was getting him this videotape recorder, my mother said, those things cost hundreds of dollars. Your father and I don't want you spending all your money on a big gift. You know, like I'd been in show business 15 years and only accumulated $379. I said, Ma, it's no big deal. It's too much money. We'll send it. It'll go right back. It'll go right back. We're not accepting it. So I lied. I said, look, Ma, a friend of mine runs a video shop. He gives me the wholesale price, $25. So there's this long pause. She says, well, $25 isn't bad. All right, you can spend $25. That's a fair amount. 2 weeks later, she sends me a check for $100. She wants four more machines for the neighbors. For the longest time, most of my relatives managed to function without the benefit of basic modern technology. My Aunt Edie, for instance, never got rid of her dial phone. Whenever I went to visit her with my parents, I couldn't make any long-distance calls because access codes require punching in touch-tone numbers. So, if I had to urgently get hold of someone, I'd tell my mom I needed to find a payphone, which she never understood. Oh, Mr. Big Shot, Mr. Fill-In for Johnny Carson. He's too important to use his aunt's dial phone. I remember the time in the late 80s when my Uncle Mike and my Aunt Rose, in their 70s, planned to visit my Uncle John, who lives in San Diego. I told my Uncle Mike, when you get to San Diego, call me in L.A. I won't be there, but leave a message on my machine and tell me where you are. And to avoid confusion, I made sure that my answering machine had a very basic greeting. Hello, this is Jay. I'm not in right now. Please leave your name and number. Could it be any simpler? So I got home from the road on Sunday, and I played my message, and I hear, Jay? Hello, Jay? It's your Uncle Mike. Then I hear him say to my Aunt Rose, I don't know where he is. I heard him pick up the telephone. He said something, and then he walked away. Then I heard my Aunt Rose say,
maybe he's in the bathroom.
Then for the next 10 minutes, I hear a television in the background, like they're waiting for me to come out of the bathroom. Then finally, he shouts, Jay,
Are you there? I don't know where he is. And he hung up. Then he called my mom to tell her that I had hung up on him. She called me furious.
Why'd you hang up on your Uncle Mike? He said he called you yesterday afternoon, you picked up the telephone, you said hello, you made a funny beeping noise at him, and then you hung up.
I said, I didn't hang up, Ma. I wasn't even home at the time. My machine picked up.
Oh, Mr. Big Shot, Mr. Fancy has a machine to answer his telephone.
I said, I'm not Mr. Fancy, Mom. Everybody has an answering machine.
Your father and I don't have an answering machine.
You're 80, Mom. You don't have any friends that know how to use an answering machine. My dad loved factory warranties. Every product he ever bought, he'd fill out the warranty card and make a copy for our files, just in case. Here's a classic example. When I was a high school senior, he grabbed me one day as I walked out and said, come on, son, let's go up to the hardware store. I want to get a new toilet seat for the bathroom. This is my dad's idea of a great father and son outing. So I went with him. He walked in the store and he told the clerk, I want your best toilet seat. What do you recommend? Well, after thinking about it a minute, the guy sold us an American Standard toilet seat, which my father especially liked because it came with a 20-year guarantee. Then, in 1988, I happened to be home again. I went in to use the john, sat down, cracked. Seat broke off the hinge. I looked at it and saw it was all rusty and rotted. I snapped it off and went to throw it away. I said, Dad, I'm going to go uptown and get you another toilet seat. He said, wait a minute, don't throw that away. You know, I got a 20-year guarantee on that thing. It was the same seat. He pulls out this warranty, this yellow piece of paper. It looks like the Magna Carta. I said, Dad, put that away. I'm not walking down Main Street with this rotted out toilet seat. And I'll do it. I've got a guarantee. So I drove him to the hardware store with this awful rotted toilet seat. And as we walk in, people in the aisles are just leaping out of the way. My father asked for the guy who sold us the seat. We find out the guy had retired 10 years earlier, but his son, who's like 57 now, comes out. My dad said, my toilet seat broke. I want a new one. The guy looked at him and said, sir, this is all rotted. I can't give you a new one. So my dad presented him with the warranty. Oh, yeah, look at this. 92 days left on the guarantee. And it was true. There were 92 days. The guy had to give us a new seat. The warranty on this new seat is supposed to last until the year 2008. When I got home, he filled out the card and put my name on it. This is my inheritance now. You know, some men know how to retire. They have hobbies, they relax, they travel. My father was not one of those guys. He hated to be unproductive. After he left the insurance business, he drove my mother nuts by wanting to add rooms onto the house. My mother would tell him,
no one lives here anymore. We don't need a rumpus room. I don't play billiards.
For a while, he took up fishing with my Uncle Lou, but like any chore, even that he had to do to maximum effect. They'd bring home huge piles of fish and then pack them into every freezer they could find. And usually that's where most of the fish stayed. One time, he and Lou got lost on their boat in a thick fog in Boston Harbor. They were out there about 7 hours. Both of them wore hearing aids and tend to let their batteries run down. In fact, the only reason the Coast Guard found them at all is because they were screaming at each other, where the hell are we? What's that? I said, where the hell are we? You say we're far? Far from what? I think all of New England heard them out there that day. But hearing problems aside, my dad was generally a pretty healthy guy. In the early 80s, there'd been a flare-up of some prostate trouble, but that seemed to disappear. You know, I would call home every day to check up on both he and Mom, and then one point in 1990, I got my mom on the phone. One thing I knew about my mom, she was the world's worst liar, and I could always tell when she was trying to fudge the truth. I said, hi, Ma, how you doing?
Oh, fine, everything's fine. Nothing to worry about, everything's fine.
Something wrong, Ma?
No, nothing's wrong. Everything's fine. Your father's going to be fine.
I said, what do you mean, going to be fine? What happened?
Oh, well, no, he didn't want me to say anything.
Say what? Ma, what's going on?
Oh, your father had to go in for another prostate operation. Nothing serious. The operation went well. He'll be in the hospital a couple of days. Oh, but he knew if I told you, you'd come running home and you're not supposed to know.
Okay, Ma, I'll pretend like I don't know anything about it. When we got off the phone, I immediately called the airlines. Like anyone else, I never liked to think about my parents in terms of mortality. But I wasn't about to ignore it either. Plus, as long as I found out the operation had been successful, the least I could do was try to cheer my dad up a little bit. So without telling either of them, I got on a red-eye flight that night and arrived in Boston about 6:30 in the morning. I went directly to the hospital and found his doctor, who assured me that everything was okay. Then I asked the nurse to help me play a little joke. I wanted to surprise him somehow. So I had them get me a doctor's outfit. You know, the full hospital greens with the cap, the mask, as well as some eyeglasses, a clipboard, and a stethoscope. I disguised myself completely and then walked into my father's room. He looked up from the bed, as alert as ever. Hello there, doctor. How are you? I took a stern, dismissive tone with him. I said, fine, fine. But I didn't like the sound of me. Everything all right, doctor? Didn't I tell you everything was all right? Oh, you seem a little upset, he said. Oh, no. I'm not upset. I was just looking at your chart here. Jeez, fuck. We get a lot of guys like you in here. What are you talking about, he said. You know,
Guys like you come in here for a simple procedure. Guys that never worked a day in their lives. Then they want a free bed and a free meal for a couple of weeks. Now his eyes started to bulge. Who do you think you're talking to? I'm talking to you, you lazy bum. Then he leaped out of bed, started choking me. He's about to punch me in the face. I said, Pop, it's me. Look, I took the mask off. He said, well, goddamn, what the hell you come in here? I could have killed you. I came in to play a trick on you. And once he calmed down, he thought that was the funniest thing he ever saw in his life. The same way my mom hated to be embarrassed in public, my dad couldn't bear the idea that anyone would ever think of him as a man of leisure, much less a deadbeat or a burden. I could have wound up in traction that day, but it's good to see he was okay. I think the hardest thing for most families to do is express emotion. I guess nothing is harder than expressing emotion between father and son. My dad and I are always real close, but sometime in my mid-30s I realized, you know, I had never officially told my dad that I loved him. Of course, he knew I loved him, and I knew he loved me, but, you know, guys are not good at this kind of Phil Donahue, Allen, all this stuff. It's sort of awkward. Mothers and daughters are great. They have no problem with this, but I don't know. That just seems to be the way it is. So one year I decided I would call him on his birthday and tell him that I love him. Just make it official. God forbid that anything should happen, and I never said that. Of course, the only thing more awkward than saying it in person is saying it on the telephone. But my mind was made up. On that day, I called, and he picked up the phone the same way he's been answering the phone all his life. Yellow! Yellow there! Hi, Dad. Happy birthday. Who's this? Who's this? I said, it's me, Dad. Oh, hello there, son. I sucked up the nerve and started going, listen, Pop, you know, you've been a pretty good dad and everything. You know, I just thought I'd call you, let you know that, you know, you've been a great dad and, you know, kind of like you and all that kind of stuff. What's that? I can't hear you. I said, oh, man, this is hard. I said, nothing, Pop. I just thinking about you. You know, you've been a great dad, and, you know, I want to let you know that I, you know, care about you and that kind of stuff. What? What, are you stuck in the car? You want me to come get you? No, I'm not stuck. I don't want you to come get me. I'm fine. I've been thinking about you. You know, you've been a great dad, and, you know, God forbid something should happen. I just want to let you know that I love you. Just want to let you know I love you. That's all. Oh, you love me. Okay. I'm going to put your mother on the phone now. Okay, Dad, good talking to you. My parents were always with me through every high and low in my life and always supportive and proud of my accomplishments. Of course, there may not have been a prouder moment than when I became Johnny Carson's successor as host of The Tonight Show on May 25th, 1992. And I was especially proud to have made them so proud. Not that my mom didn't have enough trouble comprehending the national impact of all of this stuff. 2 months before I was to debut, my face, as caricatured by Al Hirschfeld, appeared on the cover of Time magazine, so I called my mom with the big news. I said, Ma, I'm going to be on the cover of Time magazine this week, so tell Daddy to pick a bunch of copies. Oh, good. Which one is that? I said, it's Time, Ma. Time magazine. Time what? Oh, I don't think we get that one around here. Ma, you get it. Ma, it's Time magazine. It's a very important magazine. I said, call Aunt Edie in New York and Aunt Faye in New Jersey. Call Uncle Louie in Florida. Tell them, too.
Oh, I don't think you'll be on the cover in those places. I mean, I think they know you're from the Boston area, so they probably just put you on the cover in this area.
No, Ma, I'm not just on the Andover edition. Ma, it's Time magazine. It goes all over the world.
Oh, I don't think so. I don't know why people in other parts of the world would care about...
Ma, just tell them to get the magazine.
You know, I always thought my mom could have been the next Gracie Allen if she hadn't been so shy. And as I said in The Tonight Show, just after she passed away, of all the comedians I count as friends, none of them could make me laugh the way she did. She was simply the best friend they ever had. The same year that I took over The Tonight Show, she was diagnosed with lung cancer. Although she had beaten breast cancer before, she only lived about another year. During that time, there was a big media squall over whether I would keep my job. Thankfully, fate somehow prevailed in short order. Because aside from some of the comedy club horror stories already relayed here, I've never been fired from a job in my life. Even when I lost my job at Bloomington Ford as a kid, I got it back before they ever knew. And all through that same time, my dad would get worked up as only he could. If there was ever a bad review in the paper, he'd say, I'm going to get that fella on the phone. It was no different than when he found out I was working at the Improv for free. And just as I did back then, I told him, Dad, don't call the man. Everybody's entitled to his opinion. But he never stopped telling me, you just fight the good fight, son. And so I did as well as I could. After my mom died on June 26, 1993, he sort of lost his own will to fight. After 57 years of marriage, he went downhill pretty fast. Prostate cancer caught up with him, and he passed away August 17th the following year. But none of this is meant to be maudlin, because I never think of them as gone. I've got all of their stories, and that keeps them nearby always.
When my mom's health was failing, she actually used to worry about what I would do for material without her around. But she's always around. Always not quite getting it, always being funnier than she pretended to be. Anyway, besides all the goofy TV stuff I've already told you, here's one last story that'll give you a good idea exactly what kind of parents they were. When I was 14, before I had my driver's license, I scraped up $350 to buy a crappy old 34 Ford pickup truck. Even though I couldn't legally drive it, I just wanted to have my own car and fix it up and make it go. Every day after school, I'd work on it, fixing it, sanding it, painting it, buffing it. As a present, my mom and dad got me brand new Naugahyde upholstery for the seats. Then one day I slammed the door a little too hard and the window shattered. They didn't have safety glass back then. And I didn't have any money to replace it. Anyway, around the same time, I finally got my driver's license. My favorite thing was to drive myself to school. This was like the greatest thing in the history of the world. Andover High was a big flat building where you could see the parking lot from just about every classroom. But one day it began to rain hard. Because of the broken glass, I sat in class and watched my car and the new upholstery get thoroughly drenched. And I couldn't do anything about it. Then suddenly through the window, I saw my mom and dad tear into the parking lot. They screeched up next to the truck and dragged out a huge piece of plastic out of the car. They had covered the truck in the pouring rain. My dad had known that the rain would ruin the upholstery, so he left the office in the middle of the day, picked up my mom, and bought this hunk of plastic to save my seat. I watched them do this, and I began to cry right there in class. That memory has always stayed with me. Fight the good fight, Sonny used to say. Fight the good fight.